I call on Ash Regan to speak to and move the motion. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome this opportunity to open the debate on the general principles of the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Bill. And my thanks go to the Criminal Justice Committee and all of those who gave evidence for their work on the bill at stage one. And the bill is a key part of an overarching package of change being progressed through the Fireworks Action Plan and is the result of several years of work, including widespread public consultations, opinion polls, analytical research and engagement with key stakeholders, including the Independent Firework Review Group. And all of this work has clearly demonstrated that people wanted change, that they see the unpredictable use as well as the misuse of fireworks and pyrotechnics as antisocial, as unwelcome and causing significant disruption to many people, and particularly those with neurodivergent conditions such as autism, animals and communities. However, we accept that there are many who enjoy the spectacle of firework and pyrotechnic displays, and that public displays can offer a safe and a fun way for communities to enjoy fireworks. And so it's our job to proportionately address the clear, consistent concerns and call for change that have been raised, whilst balancing this against allowing the safe, considerate and appropriate use of fireworks and pyrotechnics for celebrations and for other important events. And this is what's underpinned the bill that's before Parliament today, one that introduces critical enhancements to Scots criminal law to ensure it is as robust and effective as possible at regulating the use of fireworks and pyrotechnics. And I'll outline the five key strands of the bill. So firstly, part two includes a provision for Scottish ministers to establish and to operate a fireworks licensing system, which will require members of the public to apply for a license in order to purchase, possess and use F2 or F3 fireworks in Scotland. And this provision seeks to move the purchase and use of fireworks to a planned, well thought out transaction rather than a spontaneous occurrence. And I consider that a comprehensive license system covering supply, possession and use is the most robust way to ensure that the policy objectives of the system are met while mitigating against potential unintended consequences such as the displacement of sales across the border or online. So I'm aware of the concerns raised by the committee on the level of detail included on the face of the bill, but I believe that the bill strikes the right balance here. It sets out the core principles and elements of how the licensing system will function and the requirements that will be placed on those wishing to apply for a licence. And then the operational and administrative details, I will.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I just wonder if the Minister thinks it's appropriate that the report appears to have only had one sitting day between being published and being debated today.
Before the Minister responds, I'll just make members aware that we do have time on hand this afternoon for interventions. Minister.
So I did recognise the concerns that the committee raised about timetabling as one of those issues. And I do thank the committee for their agreement to work to a slightly truncated timetable. I think scrutiny is, of course, vital in this regard, which I'm sure everyone would agree. But I think that needs to be balanced by the consideration that the public are very keen to see action on this topic. And I think if we all work constructively across the chamber, and for my part, I can commit to going through the parliamentary process to engage with all the concerns that are raised with me and address them constructively, then I think we will end up with a bill that is appropriate, proportionate and effective at the end of this process. So the operational and administrative detail of the licensing system will be set out in regulations to ensure that we can develop an agile and future-proof system which can be updated in a timely manner should the need arise to continue to meet the requirements of society. And the bill sets out a duty to consult before making regulations under this part, ensuring that stakeholders have the opportunity to share their views on operational licensing system details. And I welcome the recommendations from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, reinforced by the Criminal Justice Committee, to consider whether further provision about the licensing system should be subject to the affirmative procedure rather than negative, as currently set out. And I can confirm that I will bring forward amendments at stage two, and I recognise that this will afford Parliament an enhanced level of scrutiny as this detail is being developed and brought forward. So, I will.
Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful for taking this intervention. Given the thought that's gone into the licensing system and indeed the additional legislative support that it will need, has consideration been made yet as to the likely level of fee that will apply to a licence application, but actually more importantly, whether or not that will cover just the cost of the licensing system or also inflect on the enforcement that will be needed?
Minister.
So we have modelled fee levels, and that's been set out and that's been published. It's available for the member to have a look at himself if he wants to look at this. And the modelling has been done around a fee level of £20, £30 and £50, with the associated modelling that goes along with that. I think from my part, I'm very keen that it's not prohibitively expensive. We want to allow people to do the right thing, if you like. So I'm quite keen, and we had quite a bit of debate here with one of your colleagues who's on the committee about proportionate levels of fees, and I'm keen for my part that they remain proportionate. So in response to the Stage 1 report, I've also agreed to provide the committee with a mock user journey. So that's to set out in more practical terms how the licensing system at this stage is planned to work should the bill be passed by Parliament. And this will, of course, be subject to further consultation and agreement of subsequent regulations by the relevant committee at a later date. And so I hope this provides the committee with reassurance as to the practical operation of the system and the processes that are in place to ensure that this is developed in a robust and in a transparent way as well. Part three of the bill includes the proxy purchase and supply offence in relation to fireworks and other pyrotechnic articles. And during our consultations, we heard accounts of adults giving children fireworks in our communities. And this is very worrying, I'm sure everyone would agree. And we need to make it clear that this behaviour is unacceptable. And while it is illegal under existing legislation to supply fireworks to a person who's under the age of 18, in a commercial transaction, this doesn't cover the wider settings. And this is, as recognised by the committee in its report, a loophole that must be closed. So the scrutiny timetable for the bill will enable this important provision to be in place for the upcoming bonfire season. And I'll cover the benefits of the timetable in more detail shortly. Part three also includes proposed restrictions on permitted periods of the supply and use of fireworks, and this includes restricting the days that fireworks can be sold to and used by the general public. And the dates set out in the bill broadly align with existing firework periods, where fireworks form an important part of celebrating cultural and religious festivals. I will.
Jamie Green.
Can I ask who the Minister consulted with when she came up with these dates?
Minister.
So we consulted with all the major faith groups in order to come up with these dates. I can provide the member with more detail on that in writing if he would like more detail on that. And also we've retained a provision in the bill so that if it comes to light that there is a celebration that perhaps we have missed, we would be able to update the legislation potentially to reflect that in the future. I have, of course, been mindful for the need of equality during development of this provision, which was updated in light of engagement with equalities organisations during last year's consultation. And this measure addresses the concerns that we've heard about unpredictable use of fireworks being disruptive, sometimes debilitating to people and communities, as well as to animals. And being aware of when fireworks might be used will enable people to put appropriate safeguards in place while allowing people to continue to use fireworks to celebrate over existing fireworks periods. So I recognise that restricting the days of supply has the potential to negatively impact specialist firework businesses, and the bill therefore includes a regulation-making power to enable the introduction of a compensation scheme to address the economic impact of this provision if that is required. I will.
An intervention.
Douglas Lumsden.
Could you maybe explain a bit more what the compensation would be? Would it be an annual recurring thing, or would it just be a one-off payment?
Minister.
I can't give the member any further detail on that at this stage. I will endeavour to bring more detail forward, perhaps around the time of stage two. But we do recognise that restricting days of supply you know, it may have that impact on, it's a very small number of businesses that currently sell year-round. So my intention is to engage with the businesses that are affected to further understand the detail of the financial impact that it may have on them. I welcome the committee's recommendation to commence work on the compensation scheme as soon as possible, and an important initial part of this will be engaging with those businesses and understanding the effects that the financial effects that it may have on them. And I note the concern that's been raised by the committee in relation to the potential impact of provisions on people purchasing black market fireworks. And this risk has been fully considered during the development of the bill. For example, where any part of the supply of fireworks takes place in Scotland, including the delivery, suppliers will be required to check the licence status of the recipient receiving the fireworks delivery to ensure that they do not commit an offence of supplying to an individual without a fireworks licence. And of course, the illegal sale and purchase of fireworks will continue to be subject to existing well-established enforcement routes through trading standards, the police and the courts. And the Scottish Government intends to continue to work with these partners to build on and enhance existing processes to tackle black market sales. Part 4 of the bill provides local authorities with the power to designate firework control zones, where it will be an offence for the general public to use fireworks at any time, including on private property. Communities will therefore have a greater say in fireworks use in their local area, with a fair and robust process in place for the consideration of such zones to be designated, amended or revoked. And public firework displays will be exempt from these zones. And as I recognise that these events can and do bring communities together and will allow people living in these zones to enjoy fireworks in appropriate settings. And professional firework operators are also exempt in terms of the services and capacity of providing both public and private displays. And I note the committee's concerns on these zones and whether giving local authorities the ability to designate a complete no firework zone would be preferable. So I'm interested in hearing the views of Parliament on this point today, particularly in relation to the exemption included for professional fireworks operators whose services can be engaged for private displays. I will.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way and for her openness on this point, because for example, I have the Dogs Trust in my constituency, and really, whether it's organised or not, they both affect them.
Minister.
I agree with that, and that's why I'm very keen to hear the views of the Parliament this afternoon, particularly on that point. Part 5 makes it an offence to be in possession of a pyrotechnic article, including all types of fireworks, without reasonable excuse, while at, in the immediate vicinity of, or travelling to a designated sporting or music venue, an event, public profession, an assembly. And a person convicted of this offence is liable on summary conviction to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 6 months, or a fine not exceeding level 5 on the standard scale, or both. And the bill also extends powers of stop and search, including of a vehicle, to anyone reasonably suspected of committing an offence under the bill. And this will, in particular, enable the proactive and preventative enforcement of the Part 5 provisions in relation to the pyrotechnics at certain places and events, ensuring police can act early to address this potentially dangerous behaviour. And in drafting the pyrotechnics possession offence, we were conscious of our obligation to consider the least intrusive method of achieving our policy objective and the need to demonstrate that new criminal offences and related search powers are proportionate and necessary. I'll give way.
Edward Mountain.
For giving way, my question to the Minister is as farmers, of which I'm one in my register of interest, I declare that, often carry pyrotechnics to frighten birds away from crops, and they could be in possession of these fireworks when they're moving around the countryside. Have you given consideration to them, and what protection will you give to farmers as they're moving around the countryside with these exploding rockets, as they are, which are used to frighten away things such as geese?
Minister.
It's quite right to raise this, because obviously there's a number of reasons why people might have a legitimate reason to carry a pyrotechnic device, safety flares and so on, marine flares. So that was one of the considerations that the government took into account when we were drafting this offence, and why the offence has been drafted in a slightly narrower way than it had been previously suggested, in order that we didn't for any reason affect people who need to legitimately. We don't want to put people off carrying flares for legitimate reasons. But again, I'm interested to hear the views of the Parliament on this and their consideration on whether they feel that the government has got the balance right, if you like, in this particular provision. So I'm aware of concerns raised by the committee, by Police Scotland and by the Scottish Police Federation about the scope of the pyrotechnic possession provisions and their impact on operational enforcement. And I agree that we need to address operational challenges to ensure the legislation is effective, and I'm interested to hear Parliament's views on that, as I said. So while I understand calls for a wider offence of being in possession of a pyrotechnic article in a public place, I also recognise the importance of proportionality in this, in creating any new criminal offence, to ensure that individual freedoms and civil liberties are protected and that we are achieving our objective in the least intrusive way possible. So finally, I'd like to say that I'm grateful to the Parliament for allowing the bill to proceed at an accelerated pace. And moving forward swiftly is important. And we've heard the strong message that people want change and that action taken on sustained disturbance and harm that fireworks and pyrotechnics can cause on their life. And this timetable will allow the proxy purchasing events to be in place for the upcoming bonfire season. And the importance of this provision cannot be minimised. And as I mentioned earlier, we've heard about the issues that some communities face where adults are giving fireworks to children, and we must act to close the loophole in current legislation that allows that to go unpunished. And we've also heard from enforcement authorities that a proxy offence is also a useful preventative tool, as it makes clear to all adults that this is unacceptable and it is criminal. And the purpose of the proxy offence is to protect children and young people from harm, which I'm sure all members would agree is an absolute priority. So the timetable allows the important work to implement other provisions to commence promptly should the bill be passed by Parliament. And this is paramount to ensure that further positive change can be in place as soon as possible. And there's no question that there is a strong desire to see a fundamental shift in Scotland's relationship with fireworks and pyrotechnic articles. And this bill is just part of our journey towards achieving this, balancing the responsible use and enjoyment of fireworks with the need to protect the public from harm and minimise the disruption and intimidation that these articles can cause.
Thank you. I now call on Colleen McNeill to speak to and move amendment 4236.1.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour supports the Scottish Government's intention behind the bill, and we applaud the hard work of Minister Ash Regan and the stakeholders who created the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Bill. We have unusually amended the motion to agree to general principles, as we have quite serious concerns that the design of the licensing scheme in particular may have unforeseen consequences and may unintentionally criminalise individuals due to the complexity of the scheme. Just to refer to one aspect of that, if you look at the section of the bill that deals with restrictions on the days that when you can use fireworks, which is an offence if you use out with those days, that 26th to December to the 2nd of January, and the 3 days immediately preceding the first day of the Chinese New Year to the 7th day after the first day of the Chinese New Year. People may know that the Chinese New Year follows the lunar calendar, but you can see that it's quite complex for the general public to know what days they can set fireworks off and which days they can't. The low number of prosecutions and none in the last year indicate there may be a deeper problem with how seriously this issue is taken by the police and the Crown Office, and we simply have not had enough time to scrutinise whether the bill will make a difference to that. The lack of scrutiny time, in my view now in hind, is not justified as something has become so important for our communities. Fireworks, I do agree with the Minister, have become a serious issue across Scotland, with bonfire season often putting our police and emergency workers at risk. Fireworks and pyrotechnics have also been used in attacks on officers, and fireworks have been used as weapons in many communities, and such as my own in Glasgow and Pollock Shields, where it appears as though there may not even have been any prosecutions as a result of existing law. And I have to question whether this bill will do more to penalise those who misuse fireworks in our communities. Fireworks also distress wildlife, farm animals and pets, particularly dogs, and the SSPCA have described the bill as a win for animals. So Scottish Labour are clear that we do support the government's intentions behind the bill. Fireworks are an issue throughout the rest of the year too, particularly football matches where fireworks and flares are regularly smuggled in and let off, which endangers staff, players and spectators. So the stated purpose of the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Bill is to support a cultural shift in how fireworks and pyrotechnics are used in Scotland while curtailing the anti-social use of fireworks. Will those who intend to risk prosecution with their use of fireworks by taking them to football matches or lobbing them at police be concerned about jumping through all the necessary hoops to purchase them legally is a serious question. What this law will certainly do will make it onerous for people who wish to use them lawfully, and in so doing does carry risks that we have not had a chance to test because of the design of the scheme itself and the lack of scrutiny. We do need to be careful that this bill does not end up being similar to the repealed Offensive Behaviour at Football Act, which was unworkable and inadvertently criminalised great swathes of the public. Now, I want to consider in more detail what a member of the public has to do to use the fireworks legislation and apply for a licence. So anyone wishing to purchase fireworks will have to apply for a licence to take an online course and taking a fee. I'm pleased that the Minister has acknowledged that the fee is a really important aspect of it, £20 or £50, and the licence would be for 5 years. But I would say if the fee was anything like £50, I do believe that that would be a barrier and out of reach for many families. I think there's quite a difference between £20 and £50. But the person wishing to use fireworks will need to find out when the 37 days are of the year when it's legal to purchase fireworks, but then find out the 57 days of the year that they are allowed to be used, and it doesn't stop there. They'll need to find out if the fireworks zone in their area is live so that they can check where it's legal to set those fireworks off. It is an offence under Section 4 to set fireworks off on the wrong day, and it is also an offence to set fireworks off without a licence, and rightly so. But it is easy to see how a normally law-abiding member of the public may inadvertently break the law because either they set them off on the wrong day or in the wrong area. So more thought needs to be given to the complexity of this licensing scheme. Furthermore, individuals may be tempted to buy fireworks out of a white van illegally because they can't afford the licence or were unable to apply for a licence because they are online. So they're not online. So there are many dangers that we haven't really had a chance to dig into in this bill. So rather than going to a shop that you were required to present your licence, some people might find another way to do that, which is why I'm concerned about the government's response to the committee in being quite dismissive of the potential for the black market to open up. In the government's response, they do say, rightly so, that they're concerned about that, and so am I. And it was very strong evidence given by the industry on this, and I do not think we should dismiss it so easily. In the Republic of Ireland, yes, I'll give way. Who's that? John Mason.
John Mason.
Right, okay.
I thank the member for giving way. But would she accept that, I mean, when it comes to alcohol and tobacco and all of these things where there's duty and licences, of course there's a temptation to a black market, but it doesn't mean we have to not do that.
Pauline McNeill.
Of course, but one of the considerations when you're setting up a licensing scheme, which is so complex as I've described, what we need to make sure is we are not creating the conditions. And it's one of these things that hasn't been tried and tested. But if you look at some of the main aspects of it, I would say that something we need to be very live to. Because in the Republic of Ireland, the sale, possession and use of fireworks is illegal. But nevertheless, in August last year, chairperson of Dublin South Central Joint Policing Committee said that fireworks were imported illegally and stored in huge quantities in Dublin. And he continued that these illegal fireworks have been terrifying local residents across Dublin, particularly the old and the vulnerable. So I think it would be wrong to dismiss the potential for the black market. Yes, I'll give way.
I think completely. And, you know, we are alive to this potential problem of the black market. But would the member accept that Republic of Ireland is quite different, where they've gone down the route of a complete ban, and that was at least one of the policy considerations for not pursuing that in Scotland, was the risk of unintended consequences?
Pauline McNeill.
I do accept that. But what I'm seeing is that the potential effect of such a complicated scheme, if the fee is not set at the right level, could amount
to a ban. It might be seen as a ban, and therefore we have to be alive to the consequences of people who go and get their fireworks without a licence. So that is something that we need to all be careful, particularly because the bill has been rushed and it has all the hallmarks of legislation that has not had enough time for scrutiny. Police Scotland have voiced concerns about how they will be able to effectively police parts of the bill. Firework-related convictions are very low, and in 2021 there were 974 firework-related complaints to Police Scotland, which there were 29 criminal charges brought, resulting in no convictions. So that's an important point too. If we're currently not using the current law, how can ministers be absolutely certain this law will be used to bring about more prosecutions? Given that it's important that the police feel that the new legislation is enforceable, I mean, the Scottish Police Federation have voiced concerns over watering down of Section 33, which the Minister has spoken about. So there does need to be quite serious scrutiny on whether that Section 33, travelling to a designated sporting event, music event, procession or assembly, is the right one. All a perpetrator needs say, and this is the words of Police Scotland, the Police Federation, is that they were going somewhere else and that no offence would be committed. So it's not clear how police officers can prove where somebody is going. I mean, given this is one of the first pieces of legislation this Parliament has passed in the parliamentary session, it's so important for communities that we need time to make sure that we get this right. I'm really unhappy that I do accept that part of the bill needed to be rushed for the proxy purchase, but the rest of it, we should have been given adequate time to scrutinise it. Do I have time for an intervention?
I will take one. Yeah.
Can I thank Pauline McNeill for taking my intervention? She may be aware that the Stage 2 deadline for lodging amendments is the 19th of May. That's just 2 weeks away. I don't know about the government benches, but do other members feel confident that we'll be able to fix all the problems that this 70-page report identified in just 2 weeks?
Pauline McNeill.
Well, I listened to the Minister for Business when we moved the point of order last week so we could fix this at Stage 2. It's astonishing to find that they're not even going to get the time at Stage 2. I have to say, as a legislator, it's totally unacceptable. I will not come to this Parliament and stand by and allow poor legislation to go through, even if I wholeheartedly agree with the intentions of it, which I do. It's not what I came here to do. It is not necessary to introduce the rest of the legislation in such a rushed fashion. And in hindsight, had I known would be in this position, I would not have agreed at the committee stage to do this. I plead with the government to give us the time at Stage 2 in order to be able to make sure that this is fit for purpose. And with that, Presiding Officer, I move Labour's amendment in my name.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms McNeill. I now call on Audrey Nicholl to speak on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee for around 13 minutes. Ms Nicholl.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's my real pleasure to speak on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee in this Stage 1 debate on the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Article Scotland Bill. And I would like to begin by thanking all those who took the time to provide evidence to us. And as part of our scrutiny, the committee visited Blackburn in West Lothian to hear about their impressive and innovative approaches to tackling the misuse of fireworks in their area. And I would like to welcome to the Parliament representatives from Blackburn Bonfire Night Action Group, St Kentigern's Academy and Bathgate Academy, who are joining us in the public gallery for this debate. So welcome all and thank you for assisting the committee. Their successful community approach to finding solutions to the misuse of fireworks and related antisocial behaviour helped inform some of our recommendations. And I would also like to thank the parliamentary clerks and officials for their excellent support throughout Stage 1. And last, but by no means least, I want to thank my fellow committee members for their constructive approach to scrutinising this bill on an accelerated and very challenging timetable. The committee fully supports and shares the Scottish Government's ambition to tackle the misuse of fireworks and pyrotechnics. We agree with the need for a culture shift, both in the availability and use of fireworks and pyrotechnics, which more clearly reflects the serious nature of the injuries they can cause to the public, the antisocial behaviour that can arise from their misuse, and the impact on emergency services workers. The committee heard firsthand about the impact the unpredictable use of fireworks and their misuse can have on local communities, and this is especially true for those who find loud and unexpected noises particularly distressing. In response to our call for views, there was overwhelming support for greater controls on the sale, purchase and use of fireworks and pyrotechnics. So there is clearly a public desire for greater restrictions. That is why in our Stage 1 report, we reached the conclusion that the Parliament should support the Bill's general principles. However, the committee has serious concerns about whether the Bill, as drafted, will achieve its objectives. We recommend that the Scottish Government make the necessary amendments outlined in our report to ensure that the measures introduced by the Bill are effective, robust, workable, clearly understood and have the confidence of the public and key stakeholders. And I thank the Minister for providing a detailed written response to the committee's report, and it would be helpful in her closing remarks if the Minister could detail exactly what changes she proposes to make to the Bill at Stage 2, as there were several responses where the committee's views were noted, but it was unclear if the Government intends to amend the Bill. Presiding Officer, it's currently illegal for licensed operators to sell most types of fireworks to those under the age of 18. And the committee heard from David McKenzie, Chair of the Society of Chief Officers of Trading Standards in Scotland, that there is a high level of compliance amongst licensed firework retailers on underage selling. However, a key aspect of the Bill, which the Government wants in place ahead of this year's bonfire night, is a new criminal offence which would make it illegal for adults who are not classed as economic operators to buy or otherwise provide fireworks or pyrotechnics to children. And this is the primary reason for the Bill's accelerated timetable. The committee heard evidence that some parents buy fireworks and give them to their children, and at present that activity is not illegal. The Bill intends to address this legislative gap, which the committee fully supports. However, it was unclear whether the Scottish Government had asked the UK Government to make these changes via secondary legislation or for the relevant order-making powers to be transferred to Scotland, and I note that a direct approach was not made. Due to a lack of available statistical data, it's unclear whether the existing law relating to fireworks is being fully enforced. Ensuring public understanding of the new law is essential. Therefore, the committee recommended that the Scottish Government undertakes a public education and awareness programme in advance of the law coming into effect. This needs to inform adults of the dangers of providing fireworks and pyrotechnics to children and to ensure they are aware of the new criminal offence. Crucial details on two key proposals in the Bill are to be provided later in subordinate legislation, and these are the fireworks licensing scheme and the designation of certain areas by local authorities as firework control zones. The licensing system is to regulate the purchase, acquisition, possession, use and supply of category F2 and F3 fireworks by members of the public. And the intention is that this will encourage the safer use of fireworks and reduce firework-related harm and injury. And the proposal is that only those aged 18 or over can apply for a licence, and they must first undertake a mandatory training course and pay an application fee. The scheme was welcomed by the Fire and Police Services, as well as other stakeholders who see the potential for it to ensure safer possession and use of fireworks and help reduce injuries to public and emergency services workers. However, the fireworks industry raised concerns that the introduction of a licence scheme and its associated costs may lead people to purchase fireworks online or illegally. The lack of detail about the scheme means that questions remain about its workability and whether it will achieve the Scottish Government's intended outcomes. The committee concluded that the scheme will need careful consultation, design, implementation and testing. And we also recommended that the Scottish Government take the necessary time to ensure that it is robust and user-friendly, and that stakeholders' views are taken on board to inform the detail.
Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and also to Audrey Nicholl for giving this intervention. Are the committee confident with the Government's response to that call for better consultation with regard to the subsidiary legislation?
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member for the intervention. I speak on behalf of the committee in terms of the priorities within the bill for in particular consultation. I welcome that's been given, and I think members do as well. Consultation is absolutely critical to us being able to take forward this process so that effective legislation is put in place. To address the concern that people may not apply for a licence and purchase fireworks illegally instead, the committee recommended that the licence fee should only cover the costs of administering the scheme. The second area where specific details are to follow is the proposal for areas to be designated by local authorities as firework control zones, and these are areas where the use of fireworks will be restricted. The bill provides for exemptions for commercial operators, community groups and others to use the most powerful and the noisiest fireworks in these zones under certain circumstances. And Rob Holland from the National Autistic Society Scotland told the committee, and I quote, "If families were able to make the decision to live in an area where there was no fireworks guarantee as far as is possible, I've no doubt that some families would take that initiative." The committee concluded that the term firework control zones, where firework use is controlled but still permitted, has the potential to confuse the public. It may also fall short of the public's expectation that these zones will provide protection for vulnerable populations, as well as addressing disorder and antisocial behaviour. The committee asked the Scottish Government to reassess whether the firework control zone provision on its own is sufficient, or whether local authorities should also be allowed to establish no firework zones. The evidence we received highlighted significant operational, administrative, enforcement and resourcing challenges, which the committee asked be addressed during the Parliament scrutiny of the bill. The committee is keen to scrutinise the details of the licensing scheme and the firework control zones, and we therefore recommended that the super-affirmative procedure be used, which will allow us to consider the draft regulations in advance of them being laid in Parliament.
Jamie Green.
Would the convener note that concerns were raised in committee about the lack of detail of the proposed licensing scheme in the primary legislation that we've been asked to pass, and that we're just being asked to simply hope that secondary legislation will address the many concerns that have been raised by stakeholders?
Audrey Nicholl, I can give you time back for both those interventions.
Thank you, President. I thank Jamie Green for his intervention, and yes, I think that I hope that we today have reflected all committee members' concerns about the timescales. The final area that I wish to cover this afternoon is the new criminal offence to prohibit the possession of a pyrotechnic article, such as a distress or signal flare. It's currently legal for people to carry and possess pyrotechnics, except when in certain venues, such as football grounds, or at certain events such as music festivals. The new offence is to address gaps in the existing law where someone travelling to an event is in possession of a pyrotechnic. The Fire and Police Services support the introduction of the new offence. However, Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Federation raised concerns about the challenges in enforcing the offence as it is currently drafted in the bill. Both questioned how police officers are to prove that someone is travelling to an event and asked for the bill to be amended to introduce a simpler, more effective possession offence. Police Scotland also asked for a presumption of contents provision to be included in the bill. This is to address problems where someone claims a firework or pyrotechnic in their possession is not what the packaging says it is. And the committee asked the Scottish Government to address both these issues. Presiding Officer, in concluding, time doesn't allow all the areas considered by the committee to be covered. However, it is clear that there is support across the chamber to address the misuse of fireworks and pyrotechnics. Committee members are very keen to engage and work constructively with the Minister in order that the bill can be improved to become an effective and workable vehicle to achieving legal, safe and, most of all, enjoyable firework and pyrotechnic use in Scotland.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms Nicholl. Before calling the next speaker, a gentle reminder to those that wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons. We do have a fair bit of time in hand, so you can, you're encouraged to offer and take interventions, but again, you will be required to repress your button if you do make an intervention. And with that, I call Jamie Green for around 13 minutes, Mr Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Don't encourage them, please. I'd like to, first of all, pay a huge thanks to the Criminal Justice Committee of this Parliament, also our clerks, our SPICE colleagues and everyone who's really engaged with the process so far in the preparation of our Stage 1 report, be it the animal welfare charities, the National Autistic Society of Scotland and also the communities really who have been blighted by firework use or indeed misuse, some of whom we warmly welcome to the Chamber today. I want to make one thing really clear from the outset in my comments. We on these benches both accept and acknowledge that the misuse of fireworks and pyrotechnics is a very real problem for communities right across Scotland, as the convener of the committee stated. There is zero justification for using fireworks as a weapon, whether that is against our hard-working emergency service workers, against animals or pets, or just simply used to terrorise whole communities with antisocial behaviour. I do believe that this Parliament can and will send a strong message that that is simply not acceptable. That being said, Presiding Officer, the question being put to us today, though, is whether this specific piece of legislation, as drafted, actually addresses that issue. Now, I'll be honest, when I embarked on this journey, I had some reservations, because the so-called ban on fireworks is anything but. Indeed, it almost initially felt quite intrinsically illiberal, or even overkill, a phrase that was used by the committee in its report, and indeed in our sessions. It came up regularly, as if this was a sledgehammer being used to crack the proverbial nut. But as it happens, we've all been on a journey, and we've come to realise that the bill is technical in nature, complex in its proposals, a little bit controversial, and perhaps even unworkable. Now, I've worked on a number of bills over the years. This Stage 1 report, sadly, is the least positive and most critical I've ever drafted. Its 70 pages are littered with critique, with concern and consternation about the government's approach to a problem. Before I go into those, though, I want to get something else off my chest, and it will be no surprise to anyone. The truncated scrutiny that, that is being asked of us to pass this bill does two things. First of all, I'm afraid it makes an absolute mockery of how we ought to make and pass law in this place, because this 70-page report only came out last Thursday, ahead of a bank holiday weekend, and the 36-page response from the government only came out yesterday on said bank holiday, and here we are having the Stage 1 debate, and indeed we're being asked to vote on this matter and the general principles tonight. We've been asked to support the general principles of a bill in a second. A bill which is littered with complications and controversy. I want to ask members on reflection how many of those, perhaps even out with of the Justice Committee, can say, hand on heart, that they have had enough time to review the report and the government's response to inform them enough to vote on the matter, notwithstanding what their whips tell them to do. It's not on and it's not good enough. I'm happy to give way to the member.
Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm very grateful to Jeremy Green for taking the intervention. Would you agree with me that a shorter bill that dealt with the priority element of it, in other words, adults purchasing fireworks or passing fireworks on to those under 18 could be achieved much quicker and perhaps with far less need for concern and reduction in times for parliamentary scrutiny.
Timmy.
It would, quite simply, and it should have been. I mean, I'll come on to the loophole issue because it is an important point. The government is asking us to rush through this bill because it wants to close that loophole before bonfire night this year. I support them in that, actually. And that's something we could have done. The so-called proxy purchasing issue is a live one. We discussed it in the committee. But what we're being asked to do is to bypass what is well-respected, tried and tested, robust parliamentary scrutiny of legislation. We need to make sensible law. And I'm afraid asking members to suspend the standing orders and to breach them is no way to legislate, if that gives the member any comfort. Because what we're been asked to do in the next 7 weeks is truncate that three-stage process. The bill is far bigger and wider than just closing that loophole. Why? Because it creates a licensing scheme for the purchase and ownership of fireworks. It regulates the sale and the purchase and the use of fireworks. It bans private use of fireworks outside of permitted days, which ministers decided. It gives police stop and search powers, which they don't currently have. And it creates firework control zones, whatever on earth they might be. The bill is big in its impact, but it is surprisingly scant in detail, and that's the problem. So much so that the committee used the phrase a lack of detail in the bill more than five times in its stage one report. The response from the government, that from the brief time I've had to digest its 36-page response, is don't worry, just pass the bill and we'll fix all of this in secondary legislation. Well, that's great, but we don't rush bills like this for a reason, Minister, because the devil is in the detail. The very idea that we're having a stage two deadline, forced upon us in just 2 weeks, well, so that's fine for the minister who has a team of solicitors sitting up the back helping her. We don't. And I want to make sure that the bill that we do pass is fit for purpose. I'm happy to give way.
Minister.
I'm not saying I don't understand the member's concerns and indeed the chamber's concerns. I do accept that. However, would the member not accept that it's entirely normal to set out the broad provisions in the primary legislation, because that's the appropriate place to put them, and the detail and the administrative details in secondary legislation, because that allows them to be amended as the future goes on, and that's the appropriate place to put them?
Jamie Green.
I don't know when the last time the minister actually sat as a member of a committee, but she will know that secondary legislation is far from perfect when it comes to scrutinise. And the member will also know that the consultation that you need to pass primary legislation is far greater. The three-stage process is what it is for a reason. We are a unicameral chamber. We need that much-needed time and scrutiny. 7 weeks is not enough. We've all been clear about that. The committee itself, on page 63 of our report, says the committee has very serious concerns about the bill achieving its objective. The committee says, quote, the committee is concerned that there would be no time for these concerns to be addressed at stages two or three because of the fast-track timetable of the bill. That was the collective view of the committee. And I agree with that view because this is the weakest and most cautious recommendation for a bill at stage one I've ever worked on. It's no secret that even agreeing the general principles itself was quite a battle in the committee. We wanted to keep the politics out of this because I think we do want to demonstrate as a parliament to the wider public that we want to address nuisance firework use. But that agreement is in good faith, to use the language we used in the report. And the government's response to our many challenges was equally rushed and, I'm afraid, quite vague. Now, let's go back to the beginning. I want to tell you why I'm not brimming with confidence about this legislation. Because the overarching principles of the bill does the following. It bans the private use, sale and purchase for defined periods of time. It regulates and restricts the retailers who sell them to the public. And it criminalises members of the public for usage of fireworks outside of randomly selected dates, punishable, apparently, by 6 months in prison. Not that anyone goes to prison for 6 months in Scotland as it is. Which all might seem well and good to those watching, thinking, thank goodness Parliament's doing something about it. But the industry themselves tell us, I quote, that this might have the opposite effect, and increase the number of people who use fireworks inappropriately, the exact opposite of what the Minister and the communities of Scotland want. Their words, not mine. Because at the moment, we really only tend to associate fireworks with major celebrations, bonfire night and Hogmanay. But this bill, as drafted, now magically encourages use on 57 days per year. 57 days is a lot, Minister. And the chosen days when we can use fireworks is rather ambiguous, arguably discriminatory. For example, Chinese New Year and Diwali are in there, and that's great. And the Minister told me that, of course, there was widespread and extensive inclusive consultation well and good. So I will ask the Minister, who in the Muslim community said that they were happy to be Eid, for Eid to be left off this list? Who in the Jewish community said they were happy for Hanukkah to be left off this list? Who in the secular community said they were happy for Beltane to be left off this list? Because if that consultation was true to its value and its point, then why are those dates not in your magic list of when we can use fireworks? Happy to give away.
I feel we've already had this exchange, but I will confirm to the member that extensive consultation was taken in order to address the points the member is making, and that the dates included in the bill reflect the dates that were provided to us where fireworks are traditionally used as part of the celebration. And I've also explained to the member already that we have retained a power within the bill that should any further dates come to light that are not covered, the bill can be updated.
Jamie Green.
That makes my point exactly, is that people will challenge this. It's inevitable that people will challenge this, and more and more and more dates will be added. Now, I'm of the view, actually, we shouldn't be restricting to that extent, but people who want us to tackle fireworks in a more restrictive way will be thinking this bill just makes a complete mockery of the principle of it by simply adding and adding and adding as people challenge the government for its discriminatory use of when we can and can't use them. And the bill also does one other thing which overarches a lot of it, and that is this utterly ridiculous situation where you can let off fireworks, you can't let off fireworks in your own garden, but if your neighbour can afford to pay a company to do it, they can do it because they're exempt from the legislation. Well, who will be able to buy fireworks after we pass this bill? You need a licence, you need to pay a fee, but we don't know how much the fee is. You need to sit a test, but we don't know what is in the test or who will administer it. And only then will you be able to purchase fireworks on the 37 days per year that you can purchase them. That 37 days is not the same as the 57 days that you can use them. Confused? I don't blame you. Of course, none of this is even in the bill itself. I need to make some progress. We've been asked to hope for the best, that this will all just work out. The other point that we will make in our comments today is the impact on the industry. There are 10 family-owned, small family-run businesses across Scotland who will effectively shut their doors. We're killing their market, and we need to be aware of that. And it's all very well saying, don't worry, there'll be compensation, but don't ask me what it is, because I don't really know yet. They need to know that, and they need to know it before we pass this bill at stage three. There are very valid questions about the black market. How many substandard, dangerous products will find their way into our streets, into our homes, into people's hands, and end up in hospital? How many of those white vans that we know already exist in communities will appear or multiply? How many of those will see this as an opportunity to flood the market outside of the defined periods where we can buy fireworks? The committee, again, I refer to our own words, the committee is not convinced that the proposed licensing scheme will achieve the outcomes which the Scottish Government intends or how it will work in practice. That's hardly a ringing endorsement, presiding officer. I read the Scottish Government's response, and it seems to say, don't worry, we will consult on this, but we can't do that in the next couple of weeks. Just pass the bill and we'll fix it. And this is my last point, and this is the one that really bugs me the most. It is entirely unclear to us as a Parliament if we even need to further legislate to criminalise the use, the sale and the purchase of fireworks, because we already have laws which do a lot of this. Over the last 5 years, there were 6,000 incidences with fireworks recorded by Police Scotland. 6,000 incidents recorded. Of those, 518 crimes were recorded under the Explosive Substances Act 1883 and the Keeping the Supply of Explosive legislation. There were only 136 charges brought about under various offences over that time period, of which only 16 resulted in a criminal conviction. 16 criminal convictions over 5 years. Let's take a snapshot of last year alone. There were 974 firework-related complaints to the police last year. There were 29 criminal charges brought, and guess how many convictions? None. Absolutely none. It is already illegal to use a firework as a weapon. It is already illegal to use a firework as an antisocial behaviour, or to attack people, including emergency service workers, or use it to vandalise properties. Maybe, and let's have a think about this, if we actually use the laws that already exist to their full extent, maybe we would think twice about rushing this bill through. Because I want something to be done, even as a pet owner. But that something could start now. The government was presented a 10-point plan by the industry on improving safety and tackling antisocial behaviour, and that's largely been ignored. This bill creates so many exclusions, exemptions and uses permitted of fireworks, it is almost pointless. It's half-baked, it's half-hearted, and it's messy. It doesn't go as far as a ban, and it regulates to the point of confusion.
The whole point is the public want action, and I share that sense of frustration. It's a palpable sense of frustration. But maybe that action should be using the laws that we already have. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I will end where I started. We as a committee worked hard, positively and constructively together, to agree to a report which did this issue justice. But we caveated pretty much every single conclusion of the report, which is completely shredded in doubt and suspicion. We want to help the government achieve this, but the government needs to help us in return. I will say that we will support the general principles of this bill simply to allow it to pass through the next stages of the process, because I do want the public to know that this is an issue we really are taking seriously. But this report fills no one with confidence, and I'm afraid I don't know if we'll be able to fix it in the few short weeks that we have. This is a mess, and this is a mess of the government's own making. Bad law will help no one, Presiding Officer. If the government is really serious about this issue, it needs to read the committee's report cover to cover and come back to us with a concrete and detailed response, detailed proposals on how it will actually address the issues concerned. We've done our bit, Presiding Officer. Now the minister must do theirs, and they must do it properly, and goodness, they must do it fast.
Thank you very much, Mr Green. We now move to the open debate. I call firstly Fulton McGregor to be followed by Sue Webber. Mr McGregor, a generous 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as a member of the Justice Committee, it gives me great pleasure to speak in this debate today. And like others, I think I've already indicated, I think it's fair to say that I came into the process of scrutinising this bill, believing that it was perhaps more straightforward than in reality it has turned out to be. I also do think it's worth putting on the record that I don't think the time constraints have been particularly helpful, as more questions arose as we move forward the scrutiny process. That said, I fully understand the reasons for this, to have some provisions around proxy purchase in place for this bonfire season. And I think it's also important to say that while it's important to have on the record the concerns about the timescales, all committee members did agree to the amended timetable, albeit with some reluctance. And I know that some members have perhaps went back a step in that for good reason, but I think it's also important to say that the committee did agree to the new timetables, and I think that we should stick to that, what we agreed to. And there are undoubtedly some concerns with this bill, and I will come to that myself, but at its heart, as others have said, is an attempt by the government to address the serious threats fireworks and pyrotechnics pose and indeed cause to our communities. And although we do not have all the powers to act in this area, our constituents expect us to do what we can, and it's clear to me that legislation is needed. Fireworks are explosives, and there are risks of injuries with their use. We heard that the types of injuries are wide-ranging, with eye and hand injuries being the most common, and that they tend to spike around festivals and during private displays. So this is serious stuff. As well as causing environmental pollution, fireworks often cause significant levels of noise, and this is particularly distressing for anyone with increased noise sensitivity, such as those with PTSD and those with autism. Indeed, Rob Holland, Acting Director of the National Autistic Society Scotland, outlined to the committee the great distress fireworks can cause for people with autism. And this, I think we all agree, is just not acceptable. And fireworks can also have greatly negative effects on animals too, pets and wildlife. And anyone who owns a dog, I don't, but I know lots of people do, will be all too aware of the stress and anxiety that they exhibit on the evening, certain celebrations and holidays where fireworks are involved. So the proposed bill looks to address these issues by introducing the following restrictions. The bill will introduce a licensing system for buying, processing and using fireworks. The criteria for a license being granted are focused on demonstrating that an individual can use fireworks in a safe, responsible manner. There would also be a requirement to successfully complete a fireworks training course before a license was granted. It will be a criminal offence to buy, possess or use fireworks without a license, or to supply fireworks to a person without a license. It will also be an offence to give fireworks or pyrotechnic articles to a child, or to buy them on behalf of a child. Yep.
Liam Kerr.
Yeah, I'm very grateful. I'm not on the committee, and due to the lack of scrutiny time, I'm not over the detail of this. But can the member tell me, is there a risk that by imposing these restrictions on retailers and consumers, that the consumer ends up buying online and ending up in the same position as they were before, but a load of Scottish businesses have been put out of business?
Fulton McGregor, well, and give you the time back.
Yeah, I thank the member for that intervention, and he'll be glad to know that it's issues that the committee have looked at in detail and referred to in the report, and I'll perhaps come back to that in a wee bit. But in terms of the online, if the person's buying online, you know, they will need to comply with the legislation the same as a shop. But I'll come back to maybe, I think, where the member's going in terms of a black market and perhaps a wee bit. And as we have heard, there are concerns about how effective this scheme might be. Will some people simply not apply for a licence but use fireworks regardless? Will some people be able to better afford the fee than others? We've already heard about that. And these are questions that I would urge the government to continue to consider in moving forward to stage two. The bill also proposed to give our local authorities the power to designate fire control zones, whereby the use of fireworks in these areas would be restricted. This would greatly lessen the risk of firework-related injuries and members of the public, and help reduce the levels of noise-related stress for much humans and animals suffering. The committee have also recommended that how these will work in practice needs to be relayed to the general public, and I think that's an important point. The bill will also look to make it an offence to be in possession of pyrotechnics while travelling to or attending certain places or events, and the Minister covered that in great detail, and I think that is a very, very important issue, because we're all now quite familiar with pyrotechnics being used at particular sporting events and elsewhere. The bill will also restrict the number of days each year when certain fireworks can be supplied in Scotland. The Scottish Government, as we've heard, engaged with various faith groups to ensure that important festivals would not be overlooked. And the reasoning behind this provision makes common sense and seems to have wide support from the stakeholders we heard from, mainly as it allows people affected by fireworks to take action to mitigate any associated harms. However, as my colleague Jamie Green articulated, the committee did have some concerns with this. For example, the government deciding what days are important could potentially be problematic in an ethical sense. You know, if the government are deciding, you know, what days are important, I'm sure that that's not been lost in the minister, that other people might disagree with that. And also, with so many days scheduled, this is potentially confusing to the wider public as to when police may take action in firework use. I do, however, think that this is a difficult question to answer, and perhaps more local authority flexibility around locally important dates could be given more consideration by the government. The restriction on the amount of days will affect retailers too, as we've heard, and the committee have acknowledged this. David McKenzie, who is the chair of the Society of Chief Officers of Trading Standards in Scotland, raised the point that these restrictions will have a significant effect on businesses that sell fireworks all year round, and noted that the legitimate interests of such businesses should be taken into account, and I do think that we need to do that, and we need more information on the compensation scheme. There are also concerns raised about the possibility of a black market growing, where perhaps Liam Kerr was going with his question, with Ireland being cited to us as an example. However, when the committee asked the Irish government for the response to this, they did not seem to raise any specific concern. That said, I think it is something that the government must continue to monitor very closely.
I'm
very grateful. It's not the black market I'm concerned about. It's the perfectly legitimate people just saying, I'm going to go online and I'll buy from there because I don't need to have any restrictions on me. It's not the black market.
Fulton MacGregor.
Well, if it's a legitimate purchase, I think it would be expected that online retailers would be subject to the same conditions as anybody else. In concluding, Presiding Officer, the proposed legislation is a clear support of the public, as evidenced by a significant number of consultation gathering, opinion polling and engagement opportunities that the Scottish Government has undertaken. Other countries and jurisdictions have taken similar actions, often stricter, and I think it is right that we do what we can within the powers we have to curb firework use. The bill is not yet the finished article, and there is nobody denying that, but I believe that we do have the potential to make it better and more robust at stage two, with this Parliament working together to achieve that, like we have done through committee. Part of the bill will be about simply taking another step in our journey to changing our relationship with fireworks. Like seatbelts and the smoking ban, it won't change everyone's behaviour overnight, but through time it will help shift behaviour by demonstrating where the government and Parliament stand on it. With the caveats outlined in the committee report, I support the general principles of the bill and would encourage the Parliament to vote for it at decision time tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr MacGregor. I now call on Sue Webber, who will be followed by Rona Mackay for around about 4 minutes, Ms Webber.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I welcome the chance to speak in this debate today, and we can all agree that more action should be taken to tackle antisocial behaviour involving firework misuse, which can cause so much harm to our emergency workers, people sensitive to loud noises and, of course, our pets. And of those of you that don't know in the chamber, I have a lovely puppy that's involved in a competition. referencing the Dogs Trust, references they've contacted us to remind us that dogs generally feel safer and more secure when they can predict and control their environment. So fireworks, which are inherently loud, bright, unpredictable and difficult to escape from, can cause them immense stress and has a negative impact on their welfare. Fireworks can elicit undesirable behavioural responses such as avoidance and hiding away, not eating, trembling, shaking, panting, not being able to settle, agitation, etc. All as the physical manifestations of them trying to cope with a perceived threat that they do not understand. I don't know how Alfie will react, he's only 4 months old, but I will be glad to know that he will not be as stressed in the next time. However, just because we know something needs to be done does not mean we should be rushing the decision-making process. This bill is being rushed through Parliament so the SNP government can avoid proper scrutiny. The consultation showed support for taking tough action on firework misuse, and we agree that tough action needs to be taken to tackle the antisocial behaviour with fireworks. But this law is being rushed through Parliament and it is poorly drafted. Bad law will not fix the problems that the public clearly want to be addressed. There has not been enough time to scrutinise this bill and it has significant flaws. There is not a single full day between the Criminal Justice Committee Stage 1 report and Parliament debating the proposal. Scottish Parliament standing orders state a Stage 1 report must be published at least 5 sitting days before Parliament considers the general principles of a bill, which has not happened in this situation. The bill's proposed licensing system has not been fleshed out, the firework control zones are confusing, and the impact of the bill on the growth of a black market and the future of fireworks industry, online or in person, has not been made clear. In the Lothian region, antisocial behaviour involving fireworks has been a long-standing issue in Blackburn. There were fireworks misuse by individuals at various times of the year, especially around Bonfire Night on the 5th of November in Blackburn. However, over several years, the antisocial behaviour around Bonfire Night became more intense and problematic. In 2017 and 18, police in riot gear were called in to deal with the situation because it got so bad. And because of this, the Blackburn Bonfire Night Action Group was formed. However, some in this group were not convinced about how firework control zones would be policed and could have the reverse effect of intended. While it would be good to have measures in place by Bonfire Night this year to tackle antisocial behaviour, it's not Parliament's fault that the SNP government wasted so much time they were unable to present the bill at an earlier date. Police have highlighted potential enforcement issues as well with the bill as drafted, and the Fire Service point out that the firework control zones may simply shift the location of antisocial behaviour. These issues must be addressed before the bill becomes law. And we at the Scottish Conservatives support doubling the maximum sentence for assaulting an emergency worker. And under current legislation, the maximum sentence for assaulting an emergency worker is 12 months. I'm actually closing, thank you. It's up to me. Sorry. The SNP's ban on prison sentences of 12 months or less means those convicted under this law will avoid prison. While we are broadly supportive of the intentions of the bill, the SNP government have failed to provide sufficient details of the proposals so far. The SNP government needs to give Parliament sufficient time to scrutinise these changes that need to be made to the bill, and they must be addressed before it becomes law. Thank you, Deputy President.
Thank you, Ms Webber. You're right on the interventions, but Purdah rules do prevent campaigning on the Holyrood Dog of the Year elections in the Chamber. I now call on Rona Mackay to be followed by Martin Whitfield for around 6 minutes. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Justice Committee, I'm pleased to be speaking in today's Stage 1 debate of the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Article Scotland Bill. This bill is complex with many moving parts, so can I too thank the Justice Clerks and the Bill team for turning around the Stage 1 report so quickly? It truly was a Herculean effort. And can I thank the Minister for responding to the report in time for today's debate. Presiding Officer, we've heard in the opening speeches the challenges this bill presented to the committee, and there are challenges surrounding the fast-tracking of this bill. But in all honesty, I don't believe the general public care too much about our parliamentary processes. They just want the noise and annoyance of fireworks going off in their neighbourhoods with increasing regularity to stop. We know this to be true from the public consultation carried out in 2019, which returned 16,420 responses, and 94% of those respondents said they would welcome increased control of the use of fireworks. It was... Yes.
Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. I don't necessarily disagree with the member's point, but she will presumably accept that what the public really wants is legislation that has been fully scrutinised and has been shown that it will work, rather than just something put in place for the sake of it.
Rona Mackay.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, obviously legislation will have to work, and we will have the chance for scrutiny at stage two. And, you know, I think the public just want to see us taking action now. It's quite clear that they do. It's clear that something had to be done about the burgeoning use of fireworks, once only set off on November the 5th, and now being used regularly throughout the year. So let's start at the beginning. The purpose of this bill is to protect public and community safety and well-being by ensuring fireworks and pyrotechnics don't cause harm, distress or serious injury. Because unfortunately, presiding officer, that is all too often what they do. This bill introduces a cultural shift in how fireworks and pyrotechnics are used in Scotland, and it's a cultural shift that the people of Scotland clearly want. Speaking personally, I would have preferred the changes to mean licensing for organised displays only. But it's not within the Scottish Government's power to ban the purchase of fireworks, as consumer law is not fully devolved to Scotland. The bill that we're debating today will introduce licensing, restrictions on supply and use of fireworks, firework control zones, pyrotechnic articles at certain venues or events, and it deals with exemptions and enforcement. There's certainly a lot in there, and not really enough time in 6 minutes to go into detail in every aspect. As we've heard, most provisions will be introduced next year, but the bill has been fast-tracked to plug a gap in current legislation to ban the proxy sale of fireworks or pyrotechnics to young people under the age of 18 this year. Presiding officer, it's crucial for the Scottish Government to respond to the wishes of the public, and this is the start of a framework in conjunction with the Independent Firework Review Group that will shift the landscape for years to come when it comes to the public buying and using fireworks. The committee asked why it wasn't possible to introduce this year's relatively minor provision by secondary legislation, but the Fireworks Act 2003 relates to commercial supply and again is reserved to the UK Government. But as I said earlier, this will be of little or no interest to the general public, who just want us to get on and do something. So the committee heard compelling evidence from Police Scotland, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, SSPCA and the National Autistic Society Scotland that they supported restrictions on the sale and use of fireworks. And here's why. Neurodiverse people, war veterans, the elderly, and of course pet owners and livestock owners dread the noise and disruption fireworks cause. Whole neighbourhoods sound like war zones and the emergency services are on high alert. I vividly remember the terror my dogs went through with each ear-splitting bang. Fireworks may be lovely to look at, but why do they need to be so loud and disturbing? Is all that noise and distress really worth it? Which brings me on to a line of questioning my colleague Colette Stevenson articulately pursued, the possibility of the widened use of silent fireworks. But I'm sure Colette will address this in her speech, so I'll leave her to expand on that. Presiding officer, as we've heard, there's increasing evidence of antisocial behaviour relating to fireworks, which is why this legislation is so necessary. On a committee visit to Blackburn, West Lothian, members heard of serious antisocial behaviour in areas relating to fireworks. Something had to be done. However, there are aspects of this bill that do need clarification and simplification, particularly around licensing, the no firework zones and enforcement. And I'm sure more will come out in all of this at stage two. And the Minister has said she'll listen to the views on the no firework zone. As the report says, much of the detail around these aspects planned for next year wasn't available to the committee. And the committee asked for these provisions to be proposed under the super-affirmative procedure to afford proper scrutiny. And I'm disappointed that the government has chosen not to do that. However, the affirmative procedure will allow some scrutiny. There are issues around avoiding a potential black market, just one of the concerns highlighted by the fireworks industry when they gave evidence. The government have said that trading standards and the new licensing laws will combat that, but it still needs very careful monitoring. And there may be issues around public confusion, and I agree with Polly McNeill on this, about when they can buy and set off fireworks, the level of the licence fee, and that's vital that that must be reasonable and affordable and the enforcement of the new regulations. I note that the government is committed to introducing a mock user journey for the licensing system to set out in more practical terms how the systems plan to work in advance of Stage 3, and I really welcome that. It's essential that a large public awareness campaign should be launched by the government so that people understand the new legislation from the outset. Presiding Officer, as the Convener said, the committee will work with the government on the next crucial stages of the bill to clarify some of these concerns. In conclusion, the government wants people to enjoy fireworks safely and to reduce the public nuisance element that they're becoming. And this is the start of that journey, to make firework use safer and less intrusive for everyone. And I urge the Chamber to pass the general principles at decision time tonight.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call on Martin Whitfield to be followed by Colette Stevenson for around 6 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to participate in the Stage 1 debate and indeed to follow Rona Mackay's contribution. And I can say at the outset that I agree with the bill's intentions, and I pass my compliments to the Criminal Justice Committee for a very long and excellent report. You know, myself and Scottish Labour recognise the majority of people want to enjoy fireworks and believe that this should be allowed, but allowed responsibly. But we also understand the impact that the dangerous misuse of fireworks has upon the public, including those who discharge the fireworks themselves, as well as the burden that this puts on our police and emergency workers. And I welcome the preventative measures aimed at addressing the concerns over the misuse of fireworks, and especially of keeping people and our animals safe. Yet, in line with the committee, I remain very concerned that there are gaps, there's lack of clarity in this bill, and indeed that gap and clarity might undermine the intentions of this legislation. I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the Dogs Trust for their briefing on the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Article Scotland Bill, because as they say, as a dog welfare charity, they report the very negative experience of fireworks. Dogs generally feel safer, as we've heard, and more secure when they can predict and control their environment, and need not just dogs, but also cats and other pets. But also children and young people and other members of our community who fear the nights of fireworks because of the noise, because of the unexpected environment. And to be honest, this bill isn't going to put that right, because we are still going to have fireworks. And there is still a tension between these two points of principle. One, how do we protect our communities of Scotland in the best possible way? But also, how do we allow celebration through fireworks of major cultural events, both for some communities, but also with Scotland as a whole? There are some areas of concern, and the first that I would like to look at is that of supply to those under 18 years of age. In the committee report at paragraph 65, they stated, the government's decision to use this bill as a means to address this issue also means the substantial, complex new provisions to restrict firework receive limited scrutiny, in which much of the substantial detail being left to regulations that will follow. And in its response, the government have said, well, indeed, the government have not said, they were wholly silent on this element of the concern. And I would welcome the minister's views on this and whether, and probably more importantly, how the government intends to develop and allow scrutiny, both by this chamber, but also, as I mentioned, in intervention stakeholders outside of here about the proposals that are being put forward. And given the short expedited table, we do not intend to end up in a census situation running up to November 2022, where we're rushing to get elements of this bill onto the legislature. My second area of concern relates to the licensing system being proposed. And I note the committee's support for the licensing system, although indeed much of the detail is lacking. The government believe the system will not lead to a, quote, black market in fireworks. But illegal markets have developed elsewhere and indeed have developed in other products, I think in particular of tobacco. In its response, the Scottish Government said they note the request of the committee for an outline of the steps that will be taken to prevent the potential growth of a black market. But the government go on to say that they consider that the licensing system itself strikes the balance between ensuring the necessary safeguards are in place for fireworks purchase and used in safe, appropriate ways. But the government have not set out the steps that they will take to prevent the development of an illegal market. They merely reiterate that it won't happen. and I don't share the confidence with the government in this. If the government can set out the steps, first to identify the development of an illegal market, but then secondly, how it will stop that developing, I think that would be very helpful moving forward with the bill. The committee specifically asked at paragraph 194, the Scottish Government should consider the illegal acquisition of fireworks and pyrotechnics may occur. Furthermore, it is unclear how current legal online purchases will work across the UK. In the response, the government has said at paragraphs 30 to 33 that displacement of fireworks sales, indeed I think this was mentioned in one of the interventions, the displacement of fireworks sales will not happen because of the licence system and that the bill covers the entire supply system. But illegal markets develop and operate outside of systems. That's why they are illegal markets by their very nature. And unfortunately, I fear that those, perhaps, if I use the word carefully, entrepreneurial skills may see an opportunity to make money at the expense of legitimate suppliers. So can I ask what confidence the Minister has that the policy will not be invalidated with an increased supply of unregulated fireworks? And by unregulated, I don't mean in their manufacture, but in the whole supply system. The licensing system set up by the government and the enforcement, of course, will rest with Police Scotland and local trading standards. And given the crisis in recruitment for local trading standards and the cuts applied over the last 14 years to local government, what confidence does the Scottish Government have that local authorities will be in a position to enforce this successfully this November, within this year's financial year? I am aware of in the response from the government that they will continue to discuss this with COSLA, but I would like assurances that the funding will be in addition rather than be expected to come from other budgets within local authority control. The proposed licence system is very complex and it lacks key details, and it would be helpful to have those. And if I can indulge upon the Deputy Presiding Officer, two elements that do concern me with regard to the dates and the power the Minister seeks to regulate additional dates. Have thoughts been made with regard to sporting events where pyrotechnics are used frequently both at the start and the end of games and indeed tournaments? And also a thought towards the children galas on the east coast of the country where fireworks also play a predominant part. So finally, given the nature of the scrutiny at this stage, although the legislation may deliver a cultural change in the use of fireworks at private events, it is not really clear how this will address firework misuse and antisocial behaviour, which is, I believe, what the people of Scotland are most concerned, and they remain an area of concern with myself. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Whitfield. And I call on Colette Stevenson for, again, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Criminal Justice Committee, I am pleased to speak today in support of the general principles of the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Articles Scotland Bill. There is a balance to be struck between the responsible enjoyment of fireworks and tackling misuse and the negative impacts of noise. Many respondents to the consultation asked for more action on tackling the nuisance element and antisocial behaviour. This bill will protect public and community safety by ensuring fireworks and pyrotechnics do not cause harm, distress or injury. Importantly, the bill will also protect well-being for neurodiverse people, for people with PTSD and for animals, demonstrated by the support for the bill from stakeholders including the Dogs Trust, the National Autistic Society Scotland and the SSPCA. Through the introduction of a fireworks licensing system and new criminal offences, the bill will ensure appropriate action is taken over the sale and use of fireworks, as well as reducing the misuse of flares. In terms of getting the balance right, many people view organised fireworks displays as fun and an important cultural tradition. Professional displays are popular, particularly at Hogmanay and for Guy Fawkes Night. By their nature, most people in the community are aware when and where this is happening and can plan accordingly. For example, people with autism and PTSD or pet owners can make plans to minimise the potential impacts. However, I'm sure other members have heard the sentiments of people that, when fireworks start going off randomly from October onwards, the impact of the noise can be distressing and antisocial behaviour can be very frightening. From a personal perspective, I know the effects fireworks can have on dogs. I've had to get in touch with the vet to get medication to settle my dog. I believe the steps outlined in the bill will help tackle this. On the theme of noise disturbance, I want to talk about the potential for low-noise fireworks. When I shared the consultation on my Facebook page, a lot of people got in touch asking, could we not just have silent our low-noise fireworks? In committee, I asked the Minister whether the legislation could perhaps incentivise people to buy lower-noise fireworks. I appreciate the Minister's interest in this and that there is scope to include this following further talks with industry. In an evidence session with representatives from the fireworks industry, we heard that low-noise fireworks are not new and are on the market. I want to reiterate my line of questioning to those representatives and their answers, because it is important. Low-noise fireworks are readily available and cost roughly the same as high-noise fireworks. I accept that many consumers don't know that lower-noise fireworks exist and that staff can only do so much to encourage people to try them. I hope... Yeah, happy to take an intervention. Thanks.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the member? I appreciate that she spoke about this a lot in committee, and it's an important point. I mean, first of all, there's no such thing as a silent firework. Fireworks all make an element of noise to one extent. But the problem is that the shop that we spoke to, who came to give evidence, said that people do not know that they exist. But we offer that information. When people come into the shop, we let them know that they can buy low noise fireworks. How are they going to be able to do that when those shops close their doors?
Colette Stevenson.
I take on board and I thank you for the intervention. There's no cert that they are going to close, and having spoken to those representatives as well, and I believe the likes of bigger supermarkets such as Sainsbury's, Asda, Tesco are actually selling low-noise fireworks. But I'll come on to this as well in terms of raising awareness. So I hope that this debate will help raise awareness of the low-noise alternatives and that retailers will be encouraged to stock more low-noise products. I would like to see more education on this, and perhaps it is something that the Scottish Government, the fireworks industry, Police Scotland and the third sector could jointly work on. The Dogs Trust as well made an interesting point in their briefing for today's debate around the labelling of fireworks, requesting the decibel levels to be on the packaging to help buyers make informed choices. I hope that is something that retailers could consider, and I would be interested to know the Minister's views on this and whether she could discuss it with the UK Government. However, we should also be aware that noise is not the only issue. Antisocial behaviour surrounding fireworks is a huge problem. Police officers and firefighters are often on the receiving end of attacks, which can lead to severe injury. Furthermore, just as the noise can be harmful, so too can the visual aspect of a fireworks distress for some neurodiverse people. The Bill's proposal for licensing and firework control zones will help here and will increase the powers of the police. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Criminal Justice Committee has signalled its support for the general principles of the Bill, and I hope Parliament will do so today. As the Minister knows, the committee is keen to work with her to develop the proposals, and I look forward to continuing that work. There is a real opportunity to improve community safety and protect wellbeing, so I support the motion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Stevenson. I now call on Maggie Chapman to be followed by Stuart McMillan for around 6 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking the Criminal Justice Committee for all the work that went into their inquiry and for producing the report on this bill that they have published. I have followed their discussions and deliberations on this issue with interest. I'd like to extend my thanks too to all those who gave evidence to the committee and to those who provided briefings and information in advance of this afternoon's debate, particularly, perhaps, the animal welfare charities. As a member of the cross-party group on animal welfare and as someone who's totally soppy about animals, it won't come as a surprise that I have very strong opinions about fireworks and their use. On behalf of the Scottish Greens, I welcome the introduction of this bill to Parliament. We support the general principles of this proposed legislation. We believe that fireworks ought to be more strongly regulated to ensure they are used by appropriate people at appropriate times for the benefit of as many people as possible, while minimising distress as much as possible. Although regulation of sale is reserved to Westminster, there are steps that can be taken now to achieve this in Scotland. This bill takes a step in the right direction by further limiting the sale and use of fireworks and pyrotechnics. We would like to see it go further. Our policy is to stop public sales to individuals entirely, but we will work constructively over the coming weeks to make this legislation as robust as possible. We have heard already this afternoon the varied uses of fireworks and pyrotechnics, from the spectacular and celebratory to the functional. I think most of us will have encountered, some of us maybe even enjoyed, fireworks around Chinese New Year, Diwali, and of course, Hogmanay. Fireworks clearly play an important role in cultural and religious celebrations across Scotland in many different communities. But we've also heard about some of the negative impacts of fireworks. While firework displays are traditional at certain festivals in the year, they are dangerous explosive devices that can cause significant amounts of distress to many people, to pets, their owners, and other animals with whom we share our world. Many of us dread certain times of the year, times that should be celebratory and fun. There is a wealth of evidence that fireworks can cause and does cause significant detrimental effects on the health and well-being of many people and animals, not just pets, wildlife too. Some neurodiverse people and those with stress and panic disorders or sensory disabilities are negatively triggered by fireworks. And the negative impacts on pets is well understood. I know I won't be alone in having personal experience of this. When I was a child, one of our much-loved family pet dogs ran away from home after being terrified by a nearby fireworks display. We were lucky. We found Rowley after 4 days. Somehow he had avoided physical harm. But I know others are not so lucky. The briefings and evidence provided by the Dogs Trust, the Blue Cross, the SSPCA and others outline the grave psychological and physical harms experienced by animals as a consequence of both the proper and improper use of fireworks. I stress, it's all use of fireworks. Yes.
Jamie Green.
First of all, I'm very sorry to hear the personal experience shared around animal welfare and the use of fireworks. Given everything you've just said in the last 3.5 minutes, why are you not pushing the government for an outright ban on fireworks, if that's your Green Party position, and also given that you sit in the Scottish Government?
Maggie Chapman.
We don't actually have the powers in Scotland to fully legislate for the ban as we would see it. So that is why I see this as a step in the right direction. But it is only a step. Going back to the harm that we know is experienced by animals, we understand it very clearly in terms of our companion animals, our pets. So we can also understand that other animals will be similarly affected, and we should be concerned for their welfare too. And of course, as we've heard, the grave concerns around the safe use of fireworks. At mass gatherings, such as sporting events, we've seen recently some of the damage that misuse of these fireworks can cause. There are important health and safety considerations for our emergency services too. They should not be put at risk of injury by the misuse or abuse of these explosives. Fireworks should never be used as weapons against any living creature, human or otherwise. I do hear the concerns raised in the chamber this afternoon by committee members and others about the timescales for the passage of this legislation through the parliamentary process. I too would like to see more information on and details about the licensing system and fees involved, the definition and allocation of control zones, the training that will be required to qualify to use fireworks and pyrotechnics, and more. There were some interesting contributions about exploring low-volume fireworks and ensuring decibel levels are clearly labelled, as Colette Stevenson has just mentioned, and I hope the Minister will comment on this more in closing. But to conclude, Presiding Officer, I agree with Rona Mackay and others. There is general agreement that we need to do more to protect public and community safety and the well-being of our pets and other animals, and that people want the antisocial use of fireworks that is becoming more prevalent in our communities to stop, and to stop now. I look forward to working with others across the Chamber as scrutiny of this bill progresses. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Siobhan Brown. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I'd like to thank the Minister for her comments earlier on regarding some of the DPLR committee's recommendations, and she touched upon a stage two amendment will go forward regarding the affirmative procedure. It's something I'm sure colleagues on the committee will welcome. Also, I want to touch upon the reply from the Minister to the committee regarding it's paragraph 107 of the reply, section 35(2)(b). The Minister indicated in the reply that to still give consideration for a stage two amendment on that to go from a negative to the affirmative procedure. Presiding Officer, I welcome this bill, and I know that many of my constituents will also. Every year in the lead-up to and also in the aftermath of Guy Fawkes Night, my office is inundated with emails and calls about the impact of the improper use of fireworks. I say improper because there will always be people who, for whatever reason, do not like fireworks, even professional organised displays. Better regulation of how members of the public can purchase and use fireworks, therefore, ensures that those who don't like them or fear them are less likely to be subjected to fireworks being set off at sporadic times of day and often for weeks before and also after the 5th of November. The real issue is when firework use becomes antisocial behaviour, as it can cause huge distress to people, animals and the environment, some of which we've already heard in this debate this afternoon. But fireworks can raise background noise levels by several dozen decibels, and increased noise levels can cause distress to those with noise sensitivity, including autistic people or veterans and refugees living with PTSD. And I know that certainly from people who have contacted my office over the last few years, particularly some veterans who have had some dealings with. Livestock startled by fireworks can negatively impact farmers, as we've already heard as well, and pet owners know of the sheer panic that firework noise can cause animals to experience. I do want to commend the Dogs Trust for their briefing for today's debate, and it states that fireworks can elicit undesirable behavioural responses in dogs, such as hiding away, not eating, trembling, panting, not being able to settle, agitation, urination, defecation, and trying to escape, i.e. scrabbling at the doors. For veterans who have PTSD or refugees who have fled conflict zones, fireworks can be that trauma trigger. And at a time when Russia continues to bomb Ukraine on a daily basis, and some of us in the chamber may have met Ukrainians coming here to survive, we can only imagine the triggering effect that fireworks could actually have upon people who have fled conflict zones. That's why I do welcome the bill, as it will ensure that appropriate action is taken over the sale and use of fireworks, as well as reducing the misuse of pyrotechnic devices such as flares, and it's already been touched upon in terms of some sporting events where pyrotechnics have been utilised, and actually an event not in Scotland but in England, an event at the weekend where a footballer actually picked up the pyrotechnic and actually threw it back towards where the crowd were. So that particular incident is being investigated by the relevant authorities. Presiding Officer, this bill is an important step forward. An important step towards reducing the burden on emergency services and preparing for and responding to firework-related incidents. In my own constituency, there sadly have been incidents where large-scale bonfires and ad hoc firework displays genuinely have wreaked havoc upon those particular communities and have occupied a huge amount of time of the emergency services. This has a knock-on effect for the rest of the constituency, who actually may require the assistance of these emergency services. Now, let's not forget also that fireworks, if not handled responsibly, can cause serious injury and even prove fatal. And I touch upon that because I touched upon some sporting events. Now, UEFA regularly fine football clubs in Scotland and elsewhere because of the use of pyrotechnics in football stadia. Now, in my opinion, I mean, there is absolutely no common sense for actually having pyrotechnics in any football stadium, to be quite honest with you, because they are dangerous. In addition, the fireworks can pollute the air with gases and particles that can contain metals and other elements that are potentially harmful to human health. Local air pollution, the frequency of cultural traditions involving fireworks and climatic factors can all influence the impacts of fireworks on the environment. I think also that the Scottish Government has already moved quickly to introduce regulations restricting the times of day and the volume of fireworks that can be supplied to the public, as well as the times fireworks can be set off. However, it's clear that the public want to see more action, as 84% of respondents to the 2021 consultation backed the introduction of a fireworks licensing scheme, which this bill will deliver. The introduction of a fireworks licensing scheme means that members of the public will need a license to buy, possess or use the fireworks, and businesses supplying fireworks will need to confirm that the people getting the fireworks either have a license or don't need one. The bill also specifies that certain fireworks can only be supplied to and used by members of the public at certain times, including Guy Fawkes Day, Hogmanay, Chinese New Year and Diwali. And I think certainly in the report from the committee, section 157 of the report, Alistair Hayes comment, and I'll finish on this point, Mr. Officer. Alistair Hayes said, and I quote, "I feel that the bill strikes the right balance." Now, I know, Officer, there's been a number of comments around when the fireworks can be utilised and sold, particularly for cultural events. But I think Alistair Hayes' comments, someone who has got a huge amount of experience in actually trying to protect Scotland, I think certainly should be listened to. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. McMillan. I now call Siobhan Brown to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms. Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And firstly, I want to say how welcome this bill is. I was first elected as a councillor in South Ayrshire in 2017, and the misuse of fireworks has been a constant concern to all my constituents. And I think this has been reflected in the response to the consultation in 2019, with over 16,000 people participating, and a substantial majority of 94% thought there should be more control over the sale of fireworks. Now, I know that Jamie Green said earlier that the public want progress, and although I do not sit on the committee, there has been a lot of questions raised today that I hope will be answered at stage two, so we can progress this bill due to the appetite for reform. I grew up in Sydney, Australia, where every 26th of January is Australia Day, and we celebrate it with family, barbecues, and of course, plenty of fireworks. However, in Australia, things are done very differently. For the majority of the country, public possession and use of fireworks is banned to reduce the number of accidents, burns, injury and also destruction to property. Only licensed, organised displays are permitted and plenty of warning is given to allow people to properly prepare themselves. The bill that's been put forward to Parliament today takes important steps to make the use of fireworks safer and more enjoyable for everyone across Scotland. Rather, it takes a cautious approach that is seen in other countries throughout the world to create a cultural shift in how fireworks are used in Scotland. I welcome that the proposal clearly outlines which time of the year fireworks can be supplied and used by members of the public. And I know this was widely welcomed in the digital engagement study for this bill, where it was commented that this would allow members of the public who may be impacted by fireworks to mitigate disruption by having a better idea of which dates to expect firework use. Yes, sure.
Jamie Green.
And it's interesting here in the example of the situation in Sydney, where members of the public just simply can't do them unless they're organised displays. I wonder why the government has not taken that approach. But also, outside of the use of individuals' public use, you can actually pay a company who is exempt from the licensing scheme completely to put on a fireworks display any day of the year. How is that actually going to solve the problem of inappropriate use of fireworks?
Siobhan Brown.
Yes, I thank the member for the intervention, but I do not think that we have the legislation in Holyrood to ban fireworks. So,
excuse me, no sedentary conversations. Either take another, if Mr. Green seeks to make another intervention, or take it or don't, but no sedentary conversations, please.
Okay, thank you. As I've mentioned, since coming into office, I've received many emails from constituents about excessive firework use in areas. And let's face it, Guy Fawkes Night usually turns into Guy Fawkes Months. Over the past couple of years, the pandemic has hit hard on people's mental health, and the COVID-19 Recovery Committee has been taking evidence from experts on this, and I in no way doubt the excessive use of fireworks will exacerbate this for certain individuals, especially with our troops. We all know that post-traumatic stress disorder is a real issue for those who return from the horrors of war, and that's why combat stress urges the public to only buy silent fireworks. Because a loud bang might mark a fun night for some people, but for some others, it could transport them back to scenes they would rather forget. Last October, there was a horrifying explosion in a house in Kincaidston in my constituency of Ayr. 6 months on, the Kincaidston community is still feeling the horrors of that night. Only weeks after that night, some people locally decided to let off fireworks for Guy Fawkes, and this thoughtless act caused really deep distress to the local community who were still coming to terms with the events of that awful night. And as we've heard, it's not just the people who are affected by fireworks, but also our animals. We're a nation of animal lovers, and that's why some people have real issue with fireworks. We've seen how fireworks can impact on all animals, especially dogs, and many of my constituents choose to sedate their dogs around November. I remember back in 2018, fireworks were being left off around Christmas time, and a local rescue dog was so terrified it managed to escape and run to a local park, a very large park called Belisle. Myself and other volunteers spent a few very cold days in our cars guarding the entrance to the park in case the dog emerged. Thankfully, after 3 days, the dog was found safe and sound, but was still shaking from the experience. The Blue Cross notes that the current system of the easy public access to fireworks and poor enforcement of existing legislation is having a detrimental impact on animal welfare. They further believe that if it's administered and enforced strictly, then this bill will bring about a greater appreciation on animal welfare and reduce the number of pets and wildlife that are injured or even killed by fireworks in Scotland. The Dogs Trust, along with many other groups and individuals, believe that fireworks use in Scotland should be solely limited to licensed, organised public displays at certain times of the year or for events such as weddings. I have to say I do agree with this principle. However, it is largely a reserved issue, and the Scottish Government does not possess the powers to implement a full ban on the sale of fireworks to the public. Therefore, I do hope the Scottish Government will be working closely with our counterparts in Westminster to come to a solution regarding this. In the meantime, I do believe that the licensing system that the bill proposes would stop careless individuals from obtaining fireworks and causing distress to our communities. However, I believe... I know I'm running out of time, Presiding Officer. Now, the Labour amendment today, today's debate, does make an important note of paragraph 386 of the committee's report, which expresses concerns about the fast-tracking nature of this bill, which may allow for less time for scrutiny. However, I believe this bill has been a long time coming, and I do think it's important that we progress this legislation. As my colleague Rona Mackay has said previously, she believes the people of Scotland want us just to get on with it, and I have to 100% agree, given the strong feeling in my constituency. This is why I fully support this bill and agree that it will be an important step to creating a cultural shift in how fireworks in Scotland are used. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Brown. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by John Mason. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is actually a bill we should and could all be working together on. It's clear from the consultation that the public support changes to the regulations, but the way this devolved SNP government are going about their business is a disgrace. Having to suspend standing orders to rush this debate through shows a complete contempt to this Parliament. The standing orders are in place to ensure good governance, to allow us to follow proper process, and maybe the Minister will take the opportunity when summing up to apologise to civil servants who have had to work over a bank holiday weekend, preparing reports, etc., to rush this through for absolute no apparent reason. There are many potential unintended consequences to this legislation, many of them discussed in the committee report, and that is why it shouldn't be rushed. Rushed legislation will lead to bad legislation that will take more time in the long run. The government needs to take the time it needs to get it right first time, because this bill has more holes than a sieve. But we do agree on so much. Every year, our communities are blighted by antisocial behaviour with regards to fireworks. Probably of greatest impact is on our much-loved pets and animals. I see many reports in local press and on social media about the impact that fireworks can have and the distress they can cause. It is right that the government take action to curb the use of fireworks and to regulate their sale more effectively. But what is not right is to overturn parliamentary process to do so. It is clear that the public support restrictions on the sale of fireworks, with 94% of those who responded to the consultation agreeing on more controls over the sale of these items. Many called for a full ban, but I feel that more consultation with retailers and suppliers would have to happen before legislation went further. And one of my own constituents in the North East, Norman Donald, owner of NJE Fireworks Display, said, "There's nothing in this bill which addresses the misuse of fireworks. All it's doing is punishing businesses, putting them out of businesses, and punishing law-abiding citizens who have enjoyed fireworks in their garden for years. If the public can only buy them for that length of time specified in the bill, then it's going to encourage hoarding and stockpiling, which is going to be very, very dangerous. And the government must act on the storage of fireworks to prevent this potential dangerous practice." He also raised legitimate concerns illegal and unsafe fireworks may become more widespread, which of course could have a devastating impact. We need a measured approach in this legislation to ensure that we are tackling the antisocial behaviour, but also protecting the livelihoods of those who depend on this industry. People like Norman have been professionally involved in this industry his whole life, with his business providing a livelihood for him and his family. That cannot simply be taken away with them with no compensation at all. There has not been nearly enough time between the committee report and stage one of this bill to consider the implications of it. And to legislate at haste will mean repenting at leisure. And it will be businesses who will face the brunt of this rushed legislation. The timetable was also condemned by the committee themselves, who concluded that the bill has been scrutinised to an expedited timetable to meet the Scottish Government's wish that it be passed before summer recess, only in order to bring in the provisions on proxy purchasing and prohibiting the possession of certain pyrotechnic articles in advance of November 22. The lack of detail, data and evidence has hindered our ability to fully scrutinise some of the key proposals, and we therefore have substantive reservations about their workability and effectiveness. And this is not the opposition speaking, but the committee itself. The bill is rushed, and I would ask the Scottish Government to reconsider the timetable of this bill to ensure that we get it right for everyone, from events companies to producers to the public to animal rights welfare people, anyone who enjoy fireworks and our pets, of course. We are willing to work with the government on this, but not in this rushed way. So in order to develop proposals that we all wish would work and support, I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, or sorry, Minister again today, if they will withdraw this legislation at this time, allow the adequate time required for parliamentary scrutiny, and meet with opposition parties to discuss an agreed way forward that we can all agree on. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call John Mason, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This is certainly an important subject for quite a wide range of people, and I'm pleased to be able to take part in the debate today, although I was not on the committee myself. Fireworks are very relevant for many people in my constituency, including those who set them off and enjoy them, and that particularly includes many children, young people, and I confess myself I do enjoy watching fireworks. However, others find them more of a problem, including human victims when they are used against people, and animal owners or rescue centres, which includes the Dogs Trust, situated between Mount Vernon and Broomhouse in my constituency. My own feeling is that fireworks are inherently a good thing, and I would not want a complete ban or even a ban on sales to the public. However, I agree with the aim of the bill to have further restrictions. We need to get the balance right in all this. I mentioned the Dogs Trust, and I have visited and spoken to them on this subject more than once. They were finding fireworks being set off deliberately close to their premises, intentionally to frighten the dogs in their care. Many of these dogs have already suffered from a distressing background. They had to spend a considerable amount of money adding additional doors with double glazing to try and reduce the amount of noise from the fireworks coming into the kennels. The Dogs Trust would ideally like a complete ban on the sale of fireworks to the general public, but at the least they would like further limiting the days fireworks can be sold and used, a more robust licensing system, a full ban within firework control zones, and clear labelling. So looking at part 4 firework control zones, which the committee looks at in paragraphs 210 to 269, I confess I was a bit surprised that it was not proposed to have a no-firework area. I agree that there will have to be good communication to the public as to why any fireworks should be allowed near animal centres. It does seem to me just a little bit counterintuitive. I note also that the SSPCA has concerns about the exemptions, for example, for their largest care centre at Cardonald. There is certainly a question as to why professionally organised displays should be allowed in a control zone. I take the point that zones with no fireworks at all might move antisocial issues to a different area, but in one sense, that is surely what we are trying to do, namely to protect areas which are more sensitive for a variety of reasons, including further away from animal rescue centres or perhaps veteran centres. In paragraph 253, the committee states it is not convinced that the right balance has been struck concerning having no firework areas, and again they make the point that they may fall short of public expectations. I would tend to agree with their recommendation in paragraph 257 that at least local authorities might be allowed to establish genuine no firework zones, and I welcome the Minister's comments on that. Coming up to date, it was noticeable after Sunday's Celtic Rangers game that a fair number of fireworks were set off in the afternoon and evening in the East End of Glasgow. If this is to be restricted in future, I do wonder if we can expect the police to clamp down on firework use all over Glasgow at the same time as they're involved in actually patrolling the major football matches, like cup finals or league deciders. I suspect the answer to that is no, the police cannot be everywhere at the one time, but I guess we can still hope that tightening up the law will have some impact on overall behaviour. That links then into the whole question of stockpiling that does seem to be happening at present, as we see when we get a significant football game, and fireworks start going off immediately the final whistle sounds. Clearly fans are not rushing out to the shops after they know the result, so stockpiling does appear to be happening now, and I can only imagine it would get worse if sales dates are restricted. In paragraph 205... yes, I'll give way.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to John Mason for taking this intervention. Isn't there also a concern with regard to stockpiling, as if the stockpiles last over a period of time and indeed the fireworks start to deteriorate and become dangerous in their own right?
Yes, I'm sure he's right in that, and I think the stockpiling issue... I mean, I think my main argument is there are problems along the way, and I'm mentioning some of these, but I do still support the overall point of the bill, and I think tightening things up will improve things. In paragraph 204, the committee suggests there might be local flexibility for, quote, local celebrations around sporting successes, unquote. But to push that to its logical conclusion in Glasgow, that might mean four Old Firm league games, a cup game and a League Cup game. So that would be at least six times that a lot of fans would be stocking up, half of them on blue fireworks and half of them on green fireworks. So half would get used on each occasion and half would be stockpiled, which makes Martin Whitfield's point. And I'm just not sure how workable all this will be. But I would say again that we need to take some action on this, and all of these measures are certainly worth trying. I just remain a little bit sceptical about the results. Moving on to the actual noise from fireworks, which one of my colleagues has already talked about, Colette Stevenson, it seems to me that the concept of lower noise levels instinctively seems like a good compromise to me. In the categories in paragraph 25, it talks about F1 being negligible noise level, F2 low noise level, and F3 noise level not harmful to human health. However, when I read paragraphs 106 to 113, consideration of the promotion of lower noise fireworks, it seems that there is no recognised standard or specification to identify or distinguish lower noise fireworks. There was also a suggestion that by only allowing low noise fireworks for sale to the public, people might be driven to online purchases or to the underground and informal markets, and that could make matters worse. I confess I did not find the argument very convincing. No one is forced to buy from illicit or illegal sources any more than they are forced to drive over the speed limit. Noise would appear to be one of the main problems we need to tackle. It is certainly the complaint I receive most often from constituents, although I accept there are other factors as well. But I think more work does need to be done in categorising fireworks and potentially limiting the noise in some way. Educating the public is all very well, but I wonder how much education those misusing fireworks will actually want or access. As the committee has suggested, there is room for amendments, both from the government and elsewhere. That is normal with the case for bills. However, I do very much hope that Parliament will support the general principles of the bill at stage one today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. And we now come to closing speeches, and I call on Katie Clark to wind up on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Clark.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour is at one with the Scottish Government in wanting action taken on the anti-social use of fireworks and the need for a cultural shift. But as outlined by Pauline McNeill, we have serious concerns about some of the detail and indeed the lack of detail in this bill, which of course has been rushed through on a truncated timetable. Many of our concerns are outlined in the report from the Criminal Justice Committee, and Audrey Nicholl of course has spoken in detail on that. The licensing scheme is to be introduced through secondary legislation, and our concern is that there is a real risk that there won't be proper scrutiny at that stage, given that it will not be possible to amend regulation. And I would be grateful if the Minister could come back on that point, not just about the engagement with stakeholders in the consultation on the regulations, but the involvement of politicians in this chamber, whose role it is to make sure that the detail of legislation is correct and that we do not introduce bad law. Of course, most people use fireworks responsibly and will want to comply with this legislation, but as has been pointed out by more than one member, could fall foul of this legislation inadvertently. The main problem, as we see it, however, is the use by people who probably will not comply with the licensing system and probably don't comply with the criminal law. And I believe that the focus really needs to be on how this legislation will impact with that group. We know there are health and safety concerns with the use of fireworks, even when they're used responsibly. But we also know that it's the misuse of fireworks, as has been spoken about by many members of this chamber, and the dangerous impact that has on local communities, on specific groups, and Stuart McMillan and Siobhan Brown spoke in particular about the impact on veterans and refugees. Others have spoken on the impact on specific groups, such as those with autism. Colette Stevenson spoke about the impact on emergency workers. And indeed, others have spoken about the impact on people who discharge the fireworks on themselves sometimes. We know that there is a real human health cost of the use of fireworks, and one NHS trust board put it the cost at £40,000 per year in terms of dealing with injuries. And as so many members have spoken about, pets, wildlife and farm animals are also adversely affected. So Scottish Labour support many aspects of this legislation, in particular the creation of new offences, such as that of proxy purchase. And that's why we have supported the general principles of this bill. But we have major concerns that this legislation is not necessarily going to make the situation better, particularly given the lack of enforcement of the legislation which has already in place. And a number of members have spoken about that in the debate today. Earlier this month, we finally received the Crown Office and Procurator Service data on that and found out that there had been no convictions last year. And despite the fact that many hundreds of firework-related incidents are reported each year, as a number of members have spoken about, there have been very few convictions. And that must be because Police Scotland and the Crown Office are not giving the enforcement of the existing fireworks legislation the priority that I believe this Parliament would want them to give it. And we need far more detailed information around the context of this disparity and how existing legislation is used, really, I think, before this bill should have been brought to Parliament. The proposals as they stand are complex, bureaucratic, and will confuse the public, in particular the law-abiding public. We know that the licensing scheme will require people to carry out a course but we do not need a licensing scheme to require that. Yes, I will give way to the Minister.
Minister Ashwigan.
I'm listening indeed to what the Member is saying. Would the Member accept that one of the reasons why we've had to come up with a scheme such as a licensing scheme is because we're having to operate within the restricted devolved powers that we have?
Yes, indeed, that was a point I was going to ask the Minister about, because a number of members have indicated that they believe that it is outwith the scope of this Parliament to ban fireworks. My understanding is that this Parliament couldn't ban the sale of fireworks, but does have powers in relation to banning and restricting the use of fireworks. But I fully understand that we do not have the full range of powers that could be used in terms of fireworks. But as I say, I think the main concern about this legislation is that it is going to bring in very complicated rules that in reality will not work. John Mason spoke about control zones and argued for no fireworks zones. And I agree with him, that's something that needs to be looked at. And indeed, my understanding is the Scottish Parliament could make the whole of Scotland a no fireworks zone should it wish to do so. But no doubt the Minister can come back on that detailed legal point in due course. For this licensing scheme to work, it must be workable and effective. If the public see it as confusing, unworkable or unaffordable, they will not comply with it. As Martin Whitfield outlined, there are real risks that a black market in fireworks will emerge as a result of this legislation. The Minister has said that there's not much evidence of a black market in Scotland at the moment, but we know in the Republic of Ireland, where indeed they did ban fireworks, that was something that resulted. If a person, I do apologise, I would in other circumstances. If a person is really determined to use a firework or a pyrotechnic illegally, then they will do so. And indeed, that is the meat of what the Criminal Justice Committee considers regularly. We need to ensure that the Scottish Government come forward with something which has the right details, that will not create bad law. Our fear is that the proposals before us today require substantial amendment, and that there simply is not going to be time in the next stage to enable that amendment to take place.
Thank you, Ms Clark. I now call on Russell Finlay to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 9 minutes, please, Mr Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I used to think of lawmaking as painstaking and precise, a meticulous process of gathering evidence, weighing up differing views, seeking legal direction and assessing existing legislation. However, my perceptions have gone up in smoke over these past few weeks. Presiding Officer, as a member of the Criminal Justice Committee, I've learned more about fireworks than I ever thought likely. The committee clerks and staff earned our gratitude for their sterling and very patient work. The committee's evidence sessions have been enlightening, but the more we heard, the less clear some issues appeared to become. Despite having had the benefit of the committee process, we still don't know nearly enough about this bill. Some members will be familiar with the committee's Stage 1 report into the bill, but not as familiar with it as they deserve to be, because it was only published on Thursday. The government thinks it's fair for members to digest the report's 70-plus pages and numerous responses to it to a truncated timetable that breaches the Parliament's own rulebook. It was just before 11 p.m. on Sunday when we got sight of the government's 36-page response to our committee report, and I'd like to thank the Minister for my riveting bedtime reading. Last week, my colleague Jamie Green attempted to get ministers to press pause, but without success. So here we are debating complex legislation full of gaps without knowing what it will mean in practice. As our committee report states, much of the substantial detail is left to be developed in regulations after the bill is enacted. Put simply, we are not being given time to do the jobs properly. The reason for the government's haste is they want to outlaw the supply of fireworks to under-18s before this year's bonfire night. While children can't buy fireworks, they can be given them by an adult. The committee established that ending these so-called proxy purchases in Scotland could be implemented by the UK government. However, and this may come as a surprise to people, We've been unable to establish the extent to which Scottish ministers pursued this with UK ministers. The committee describes this as very unsatisfactory, and I think it typifies much of our frustration. Presiding Officer, one thing that is abundantly clear, and to which we're all pretty much in agreement, is that many people across Scotland want something to be done about fireworks. There are two main issues. The first is their dangerous and reckless misuse, often by younger people and sometimes targeting emergency workers. The second is the harm their loud noises have in animals, both domestic pets and livestock, and some people with sensory issues. So what does the law say now? Well, anyone aged over 18 can buy fireworks. They are only sold on specific dates, including November 5th, Hogmanay, and some religious and cultural events. But there's an exception. Licensed retailers can sell them all year round. So as things stand, there's nothing stopping anyone letting off fireworks every single night of the year. The government's answer to the first problem of dangerous misuse of fireworks is to limit availability via the introduction of a licensing scheme. Now, it's estimated up to 250,000 people in Scotland buy fireworks each year. So how many of these would apply for a licence? If we look at Northern Ireland, which in 2016 issued 515 licences for a population of 1.85 million, if that same ratio was applied to Scotland, then we might expect just over 1,500 licences. So, as the firework industry reasonably asks, what would happen to those tens of thousands of people who currently buy fireworks? The concern is that many won't bother with a licence costing up to £50, instead turning to a black market. This is the last thing we need. And will licensing be a financial barrier for low-income families who want to enjoy fireworks? The government has not answered these questions. Now, the committee visited Blackburn in West Lothian, where the communities worked to counter the dangerous misuse of fireworks. And I welcome them here today and hope that this is not too long and boring. We heard of a white van man selling fireworks to children. I'm concerned that licensing will be a boon to criminals while shutting down the responsible retailers. If licensing and the bill's other restrictions are implemented, will supermarkets still bother to stock fireworks? At least one, Sainsbury's, has stopped doing so already. Again, this could create a vacuum for a criminal market. Yet the Scottish Government has not engaged with the big retailers to establish their position. The Government's answer to the second key issue of distress caused by loud bangs is firework control zones, while also limiting the number of days fireworks can be used. Now, Presiding Officer, many people who I speak to, and indeed large numbers of respondents to the public consultation, would love to see areas in which all fireworks are banned. But firework control zones don't do that. People living in them will be able to hire private companies to stage back garden shows, while certain events such as gala days will also be allowed. Not only that, but we don't know the criteria for deciding where the zones would be, their possible size, how long they would last. I ask, what is the point? The bill proposes only allowing firework sales on 37 days of the year, with 57 days on which they can be used. So, the government is trying to reduce fireworks by pushing a bill that effectively gives a green light by formally defining 57 days in which they can be used. And what of countless other religious or cultural dates not on the government's list? It seems inevitable there will be challenges to add new dates, and it's hard to see on what grounds these could be refused. The net result, even more firework use. Another significant question I have is whether the criminal justice system is making use of the powers it already has. And this has been touched upon by Katie Clark and Jamie Green. Getting basic data from the government about this has been challenging. But one statistic already mentioned by my colleague is that there were zero convictions last year from 974 incidents reported to the police. And over a five-year period, there were only 16 convictions. Fraser Stevenson, who gave evidence to the committee, is of the British Fireworks Association. and he told the committee that research they had done found the largest fine imposed by a Scottish court was £150. The crime was targeting two police officers with fireworks in 2019. Mr Stevenson asks, quite reasonably, what message does that send to those who misuse fireworks? It certainly does not appear to be a deterrent. Presiding officer, to conclude, we are being bounced into debating a bill that contains not just the issues I've raised and others have raised, but many others. We need a lot more information from ministers. That's why I urge all members to support Labour's amendment. Doing something about fireworks is welcome. Doing the wrong thing could be counterproductive. This bill seems to be the legislative equivalent of lighting the blue touch paper and hoping for the best.
Thank you, Mr Finlay. And I now call on Ash Regan to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 10 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank members for their participation in the debate this afternoon. They need to keep people safe by tackling the misuse of fireworks and pyrotechnics is abundantly clear and has come out across the chamber during the debate today. And it gives us, I think, a solid basis for moving forward together constructively. And I think it's worth reiterating that the bill is a key part of an overarching package of legislative and non-legislative change that is being progressed through the Fireworks Action Plan and through our work on pyrotechnics. And the purpose of this work is to bring about a cultural shift in the relationship that Scotland has with fireworks and pyrotechnics by responding to the calls for increased restrictions on the sale and use of fireworks and pyrotechnics that we've heard through lengthy consultation and engagements. But I accept this bill is not a panacea and it is absolutely central to achieving our objectives of protecting communities from harm and disturbance of fireworks and misused pyrotechnics. And that is why we are also taking action through education and awareness raising and building on the work that takes place across Scotland each year and the Scottish Government campaigns annually that will support this change in the culture of fireworks in Scotland. So if I turn to addressing some of the topics that have been raised this afternoon during the debate, parliamentary timetabling, that was obviously raised as a concern by many members, including Pauline McNeill and Jamie Green. And I think it's important to address the concerns that have been raised about the accelerated scrutiny timetable that this bill is following. The bill is moving at pace, so I accept that. I understand why members have concerns about this. But I just want to be clear that this bill follows several years of work, of evidence gathering, of consultation, multiple consultations, and engagement with the public and with stakeholders. So it allows us to continue that momentum for the public. And as Rona Mackay and Stuart McMillan, among others, reminded us that this is what the public want. The public wants action. So, of course.
Douglas Lumsden.
I think you're right when you say the public wants something, but what they're going to be given is bad legislation that will probably be overturned in a few years. Surely the best thing to do is follow the proper process that's set out in standing orders and do it correctly.
Minister.
I don't agree with the member on that. And I would say to the member that we've consulted on the very proposals that are in the bill. And all of them have received overwhelming support from the people that responded to that. So progressing, I've already taken one intervention on that point. So progressing at an accelerated pace also allows for the important work to implement other provisions within the bill to commence promptly should the bill go on to be passed. And this is paramount to ensuring that further positive change is in place for people and for the communities that we all represent, that I am sure have all made representations to their elected members to say that they have a problem with fireworks, as has been discussed this afternoon. So moving on to the issue of the black market. So this was raised by a number of speakers, Jamie Green, Pauline McNeill, I think Katie Clark also mentioned this, and it is an important issue. But I would say to the Chamber that we have fully considered this issue during the development of the bill, and there is little evidence to suggest that the provisions will lead to an increase. And that does include also looking internationally at countries where they have similar schemes. So there are already established enforcement routes around illegal sales, and that includes working with partners like Trading Standards, the police and the courts, and on importation of dangerous goods. Of course, that's a matter for the UK government. And I will write to them setting out what we're doing here, and to also to urge them to make sure that they play their part on this and the regulation here. But I will assure members that this will be very carefully monitored. So I hope the members will hear me on that point. And I'll just make some progress. In response to Martin Whitfield's point that he made around displacement, I will see what further detail I can provide. He mentioned steps. So I will see what further information I can provide on steps that I can share potentially with the committee ahead of stage two. I'll give way.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister for giving way? It's not just members who have expressed reservations, and these are already in the Scottish Government's own consultation. It's the Fire Council, it's Chartered Trading Standards Institute, it's the National Fire Chiefs Council, it's the National Police Chiefs Council. All these people have expressed reservations about the potential growth of a black market. All I would ask the Minister is, if it transpires, we pass this legislation and there is a boon and a growth in the black market, what we should do about it?
Minister.
Well, I would say to the member that concerns about displacement are not a reason not to do anything. I've said we will carefully monitor this, and we will carefully monitor it. I think it's entirely reasonable for members to raise this as a point, but I don't see it as a reason not to act. That is what I would say to the member on that point. So on the licensing scheme, which was another point that was raised by many members, and I accept the level of interest on this part of the bill, this provision. Of course, this is a really important part of the bill, and it's key, I think, in changing the purchase of fireworks from that sort of spontaneous purchase into something that's more of a planned event. And of course, in a moment, of course, it was a recommendation of the fireworks review group that we look at mandatory conditions on the point of sale. I'll give way.
Pauline McNeill.
To the Minister for giving way. I don't want to understand the government's response to this point. So in the licensing scheme, there's 57 days that you can use fireworks and you cannot use them out with. To use John Mason's example, whether it's a football celebration or someone setting a firework off in their back garden, not within the 57 days would be an offence. Can the Minister assure Parliament then that she would expect Police Scotland to enforce that offence? And would there be any distinction between a football setting and someone in their back garden? I mean, on the face of it, there shouldn't be, but I just wonder if, you know, what are you expecting from Police Scotland? And I think it's quite important to understand that point.
It would be an offence, and I would expect the police to enforce all the offences in the bill, but I would say that the police obviously will exercise their judgment in how they go about that, and operational matters obviously are a matter for Police Scotland. The bill sets out the core principles about how the licensing scheme will function, and which is quite normal to have that in the primary legislation. And then the administrative details, again, quite normally, that will be set out in regulations. And in order to aid further scrutiny, I've accepted the spirit of what the committees have said to me here and said that I will change them from negative procedure to affirmative in order to aid that scrutiny and to allow for members to have more input into that. And I hope that would be accepted with goodwill by the members. And for illustrative purposes as well, in a moment, the Scottish Government will also provide a mock journey in advance of stage two for the committee. And I hope that possibly that will also aid understanding of how this will work. I'll give way.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way on two points. First, with regard to the undertaking to the earlier matter on steps, can I thank her very much for that? But with regard to the fee for the licence, can I just clarify whether the fee is expected to cover the cost of just the licensing or both the cost of the licensing and enforcement?
Minister.
It's to cover the cost of the administration for the licence. And I would say to the member that we are intending on consulting further on the level of the fee so that we can make sure that we've engaged thoroughly on the fee. And obviously we had a conversation earlier about my views that I think the fee should be set at a very proportionate level and to make sure that that was clear. So we will, of course, engage with stakeholders as we continue that development of the licensing system, which I think members would expect, and I'm committed to doing so. Pauline McNeill, in her contribution, she made a point about complexity, that she thought it was too complex and the public couldn't be expected to get to grips with it. I don't think I agree with that. I don't think I agree with her assessment of that about what the public can cope with. And I don't think that we should underestimate the public's ability to understand what is required of them. After all, if we think about things like driving licences and all the different laws and the fact that the laws can change around driving that the public have to adhere to, and they manage to get to grips with that, I think it's not beyond people to be able to understand what we're proposing here. But I do agree. I think it needs to be as simple as possible, and we need to make sure that people are able to apply for a licence and that they do understand what is being expected of them. And so I also agree with the committee that awareness-raising campaigns are crucial in that. We need to help the public understand the changes to the law, and I commit that we will do that. It was helpful, I think, to hear from Siobhan Brown about the experience that she raised in Sydney and how having tighter controls on fireworks, obviously in different countries that they've approached this in different ways, but how that's quite routine that happens in other countries. On low noise fireworks, so this was an issue that was raised by Colette Stevenson. I think they are a very interesting development, and I think the member spoke about that. I think there is potential here to address some of the issues, particularly around the issue of noise disturbance. And I can confirm for the Chamber that I will keep this under review to see if a standard way of defining them comes forward. If that does, then I'm happy to incorporate that into the bill by regulation in the future. And on firework control zones, I'll confess, I thought that this might take up more time, more people's debating time than it did, but I will reflect on the points raised by John Mason and some others. And I will say to the Chamber that the decisions made around the firework control zones were an attempt to balance some conflicting interests here. So in terms of community events, we thought that community events are generally very well regarded and they're a good focus for bonfire night activity. So it was an attempt to balance having them in communities. And private displays, that was an attempt to balance industry interests. So I'll reflect on what the members have said today ahead of stage two. We heard during this afternoon's debate about the significant issues with communities and stakeholders, such as emergency services, facing each year around the bonfire season involving fireworks. And this includes unacceptable instances of emergency service workers on the front lines trying to protect communities and vulnerable people being attacked and being subjected to public disorder and wider antisocial behaviour. And I just want to take this opportunity to reiterate, this is not acceptable and it can't be allowed to continue. And the fear and alarm and distress it causes has no place in a modern, forward-looking society. I'll give way.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister? Last year, there were nearly 1,000 fireworks-related incidences recorded by Police Scotland. Nearly 1,000. Not a single criminal conviction resulted of that. The question really is, that we're all asking, is before we legislate new criminalisation of misuse of fireworks, why are we not using the existing laws that already exist to protect the public and the emergency forces?
Minister. Well, I think the member's just making my point for me, that actually enforcement is challenging in this area. And we spend an awful amount of money as a country with our partners in preventative and early intervention work in order to try to mitigate the impact of particularly around bonfire season. So I would say to the member that this is the point where we have to look at the supply of fireworks. And we have to make sure that the fireworks are not getting into the wrong hands. And so the bill seeks to put robust checks and balances in place with the supply process to make it more difficult for those who wish to deliberately misuse fireworks in the way that the member has just described to access them. And that, of course, includes provisions like the licensing system, which will make sure that people have demonstrated a knowledge and safety and how to use fireworks appropriately. So the potential for unintended consequences, I think we've discussed that here this afternoon, it's been carefully considered throughout the development of the bill. And I understand that placing restrictions on restricted products can lead to a minority of people deliberately trying to circumvent these. It is my firm view that that is not a justification for not making new measures being introduced in order to promote public safety. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, this bill has been widely welcomed by the stakeholders. SFRS said that this new legislation is hugely welcome. Police Scotland said that they welcome the introduction of this bill. The Scottish Police Federation on the fireworks side said, "We absolutely welcome this legislation and the controls that are proposed." And Blue Cross said they welcome the introduction of this bill. And the impact of the measures contained in this bill will be closely monitored to ensure they're working effectively and as required. And, Presiding Officer, I want to reiterate my strong belief that introducing the actions set out in this bill will support the delivery of positive change in Scotland's relationship with fireworks and pyrotechnics, whilst enabling people to continue to enjoy them in a safe and responsible and considerate way. And I therefore move the motion for the financial resolution and invite the Parliament to approve the general principles of the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Articles Scotland Bill.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Articles Scotland Bill. It is now time to move on to the next item of business. And that next item of business is consideration of motion 3944 in the name of Kate Forbes on financial resolution, Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Articles Scotland Bill. And I call on Ash Regan to move the motion. Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first is that Amendment 4236.1 in the name of Pauline McNeill, which seeks to amend Motion 4236 in the name of Ash Regan on Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Articles Scotland Bill, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.